Busto Arsizio, some 35 kilometers north of Milan. And you join us at the eWork Arena for further coverage in the first global Olympic boxing qualifier. The boxing road to Paris well and truly underway. 602 athletes from 113 national Olympic committees entered, all with a dream of securing a quota place to the Paris Olympic Games, the boxing tournament getting underway in 140 days' time. This is the 18th session of boxing on the seventh day of competition. Most of the contests in the round of 16, in the majority of the 13 weight classes that are being contested, is the quarterfinal winners will progress through with an Olympic quota place for Paris 2024. Exceptions to that are at women's 57 kilograms, where the 57 kilo winners at the semi-final stage secure a quota place, and in the semi-final winners in the women's 60 kilogram will secure a place along with a box-off winner, because it's the top three from women's 60 kilograms who will earn that precious quota place to Paris 2024. And during the 13 bouts we have scheduled for this seventh day of action in Ring A, you will have seen that there is a semi-final at women's 60 kilograms. So the winners of that contest will have secured a quota place. For the loser, it isn't all over, because as mentioned, there are three quota places up for grabs at women's 60 kilograms. Well, my name's Ronald McIntosh. I'll be your lead commentator for this 18th session of boxing in Ring A, and I'm delighted to say that joining me once again as our co-commentator and expert analyst is the two-time Olympic champion Nicola Adams. And Nicola, boxers getting ever closer to fulfilling their Olympic dream, particularly at women's 60 kilograms, our third bout of the session, where the semi-final winner in the contest between boxers from Slovakia and the Netherlands will have earned that precious quota place. Give us a sense of what the boxers will be feeling at this juncture, particularly at women's 60, where they're one win away from earning an Olympic quota
place. Yeah, this is it. This is where you're putting it all on the line now. This is where all the training, all the hard work, you've boxed those few couple of bouts before. This is where it all comes down to. Like, they'll be excited, they'll be nervous, and they know they're just one win away from completing their dream, going to the Olympics. And that's what it's all about.
So that bout to come in two contest time, our third bout of the morning session. Our first bout is at women's 54 kilograms. Here we see five scoring judges who hail from Kazakhstan, Fiji, the Netherlands, Algeria, and Chinese Taipei. The 10-point must system is in effect. One boxer must score 10. All of the officials neutral, as is the referee, Mr. Sean Reese of the United States of America. Well, there, the previous results of Shukara Karim, just 18 years of age from the Nigerian metropolis of Lagos. Her opponent, also a teenager, Sarah Kirkovic, just 19 years of age. She a 4-1 split decision winner in her previous encounter. So this contest in the round of 16, 40 boxes comprising the women's 54 kilogram weight class. So we're underway then, and it's a rather casual exit from her blue corner. Shukurat Karim of Nigeria. She's a southpaw wearing blue. The orthodox boxer operating behind a low-held guard, Sarah Kukovic. She's 19 years of age. Serbian national champion. Terrific right hand, and then escaping that good lateral movement counterclockwise. Comes in with a burgeoning international resume as Kukovic.
I like the way.
National champion of Serbia. And just in 2022, she enjoyed a bumper year. World youth champion at 50 kilograms. And prior to that, global success as Karim lands with a good right uppercut to the body. She took European youth gold at 50 kilograms as well. Beautiful counter right hand. And then spinning off once again is Kukovic.
I like the way Kukovic is using the jab in this fight. Straight away, she's trying to command the center of the ring. Beautiful counterpunch in there.
Again, she's finding a home for that right hand straight away. And the southpaw Kareem, oh, you saw her back off, but then she runs into an uppercut. Czech left hook caught Kareem on the shoulder. Kukovic has found her range straight away. Czech shots from both flanks, spinning off the line to good effect. And right now, Kareem is chasing shadows. They are backing off, trying to draw Kukovic into her web. Kukovic proving adept in every facet of the game. Counter right hand once again, followed by left jab. And beyond the halfway stage, you see Kareem tap those gloves together, just trying to get something going, because every success that she had, has had, and there haven't been many compared to those of Kukovic, well, she's been made to pay a price in the form of a counter, or she's been picked off before she can get her own offense away. Just as evidenced there with that left-right combination celebrated by Kukovic. Raised the right glove. Czech left hook once again. Kareem is continuing to press, but again, leaky defense is being exploited by Kukovic, who has found her range beautifully in this opening round.
Yeah, I really like what Kareem's trying to do here. She knows that she hasn't got fast enough feet to be able to catch her opponent. So every time her opponent goes walkabout, she walks backwards and says, hey, you know, come to me, just as she's doing now, which I think is a really good tactic. But then she needs to be able to capitalize on that and get in there with her feet fast enough to be able to catch her.
There she wasn't too far away with her southpaw backhand after the jab was long. There's the best scoring jab of the round, perhaps, from Kareem. And now she's looking to swarm and attack, but just look at the composure from Kukovic as she glides her way out of the corner. There's that disengagement from Kareem, but that eats up the clock, and it's not going to help her in this round, because Kukovic found her range right from the opening bell and peppered her opponent from Nigeria with plenty of punches, and that is why she has swept the board 10-9 for all five scoring judges. Kareem with pockets of success, but not nearly as many as the 2022 World Youth Champion.
Yes, Kukovic is really, really elusive style, really tall, rangy. She's using the jab, she's using the backhand to effect, spinning off with a check hook and getting out of the way. Kareem really needs to pick up the pace with her feet to get herself into distance to be able to land those shots that she's going to definitely need in this second round.
So round two then, 54 kilogram action in a battle of national champions, and it is an altogether more urgent exit from her own blue corner by Shukurat Kareem of Nigeria. She fairly ambled her way out of the blue corner to begin the contest, but having conceded the first round unanimously, there's a greater sense of urgency about her work, moving on quicker feet. And look at her coach over in that blue corner, encouraging her to come forwards. And she's not running in recklessly. She's trying to bob and weave her way in on quicker foot movements in the first 30 seconds of this round. And there's a beautiful southpaw left hook that caught Kukovic. Kukovic just maintaining the gap. But this is an altogether more urgent showing from the two-time reigning national champion of Nigeria. There she takes a 1-2 from Kukovic and is made to chase shadows once again as Kukovic spun off the line before sprinting back into range, and a counter right hand during the exchange. Now, there may have been a tangle of feet as well, but Kareem certainly landed leather on the target, and that is why Mr. Sean Rees has told a count. But we must emphasize once again that a knockdown in Olympic-style boxing won't necessarily result in a 10-8 verdict on the scorecard, as is the convention in the pro ranks. Exchange of right hands there. Southpaw right jab as Kareem trying a corkscrew right hand. And credit Kareem for implementing the tactics that her corner must have given her in between rounds one and two. And as well as instruction, Nicola, it could well have been a rocket, because the way she ambled out of the corner, it was as though she didn't have an Olympic qualifying bout in front of her. But she's altogether more urgent about her work in here in round number two.
Yeah, definitely. Kareem's boxing really, really well so far.
Cracking southpaw left once again, followed by a right hook. So Kukovic trying to get the movement going. But Kareem has quickened her feet, increased the tempo, disengages once again, trying to lure Kukovic forwards. Kukovic keeping her composure nicely, but Kareem has enjoyed far more success compared to the low the portion of success she enjoyed in round number one. Here she disengages once again, luring Kukovic forwards. Kukovic obliges. Karim looking for a jab, but it was short. Successful backhand. It was a nice shot from Kukovic.
I really love the way Karim is actually working to her strength. She knows she can't follow Kukovic round the ring, so she's like, hey, come to me. This is where I need you to be. But Kukovic is being so quick with the counterpunching and so sharp. It's been unreal. The check left hook and the backhand.
Terrific punch picking with those straight shots from Kukovic and down around her belt line. And to bring the shots from out of the line of sight of Karim, and Kukovic has really settled well after that trip to the canvas, which was a knockdown, and closed the round with effective punch picking of the straight variety. So a much improved performance and effort from Karim, but not enough to take the round, and I think that's a fair reflection of what took place over the 3-minute stanza. Kukovic was given more to think about, was touched up more frequently, indeed was sent to the canvas. But in Olympic style boxing, we have to emphasize once again that a knockdown will not necessarily result in a 10-8 round. But Karim with a much improved performance in round number two.
Yeah, definitely. She didn't do enough to take the round, but she definitely went in there, changed up the tactics. There you see the knockdown. She knew what she did in the first round wasn't working, and that's something I love to see. That tells me that even if she doesn't get through to the qualifiers in this fight, there is so much more to come from Karim.
Into the third and final round then, both boxers out briskly to centre ring. It was Kukovic who arrived there first and set up camp on top of the logo, and she is picking her punches wonderfully and has got the movement going once again. But Karim continuing to press and is keeping the attack going, making it a two-phase attack, and she did have success to the body. Kukovic using the space of the ring beautifully while under fire, and Karim keeping the attacks going with these marauding forward forays, raising her glove to call timeout. That's a risky tactic, because if Karim had quickened her feet and helped herself to a shot, she would have been well within her rights to do so. That's the referee's responsibility to spot untidy equipment in terms of a bootlace that's untied or the jersey coming out of the shorts. Kukovic just drawing his attention to it. Thankfully, it was beyond punching range and Karim wasn't able to land. Oh. Beautiful counter right hand from Kukovic. There was a successful shot in there from Karim as well, as Karim lands a left hook and then a right hand out of that southpaw stance. Not that she's... Well, perhaps she has reconciled that she may have to take one to land her own. But again, she's really going for it here now. But the movement of Kukovic is such that she's able to just glide away laterally in either direction, both clockwise and counterclockwise. And you see the Nigerian coach imploring Karim to cut off Kukovic's avenue of escapes. But how many times has she been left swinging at the E-Work Arena air because Kukovic has ghosted away just as she did there. Wonderful movement from Kukovic, the 2022 European and World Youth Champion, showcasing her boxing skills. And it's not just in terms of letting her hands go, but the way she is comfortable in the ring and used as a space of it is very impressive indeed.
Yeah, it's really good. Just the way that she's able to avoid the punches and just like there, spin off of a check hook, leaving her opponent looking out of the ring. Beautiful, beautiful boxing.
Nice left jab to the body from the kneecap from Kukovic. Just goaded Karim a little while ago, that's why Mr. Sean Reese of the USA just spoke to her about that. And that's no disrespect, but Kukovic just trying to discourage her. She lands with a pot shot right hand once again. Makes Karim miss, but Karim kept the attack going and did slap her with the follow-up right hand out of that southpaw stance. But look at that, making Karim miss by millimetres. Very frustrating mission for the two-time reigning national champion of Nigeria. And again, she's employing that disengagement tactic to try and lure Kukovic forwards. But that just eats up the clock, and the clock is very much the friend of Kukovic, having taken the first two rounds unanimously.
Yeah, Kukovic is just boxing really well. Karim needs to cut the ring down faster, not let her escape off of the ropes. When she has her there, she needs to really put the pressure on.
That is exactly what she's trying to do. But she's meeting an opponent who is flowing beautifully, has a greater depth of international experience. Remember, both of these boxers, teenagers. And again, the body language so instructive after that touch of gloves to conclude the contest. It was Sara Kukovic applauding herself as she made her way back to the red corner, where she received high fives from her coaches. In stark contrast, Shakurat Karim received something of a consoling hug from her coach. I think everybody around and in that ring knows which way this one is going to go, and it will likely be a unanimous point decision verdict in favor of Sara Kukovic, which will take her through to the quarterfinal stage. And one win away from an Olympic quota place. Let's get the official particulars at the conclusion of that bout.
Ring A. The winner by points, unanimous decision. In the red corner.
So Sara Kukovic absolutely delighted. Bitter disappointment for Shakurat Karim of Nigeria, but Kukovic right from the opening bell showcased her wide variety of boxing skill. Terrific repertoire of punches, fantastic movement in every direction, and she carried out the game plan drawn up by her coaches practically to perfection. Knocked down in the second round when she was tagged by a shot as the southpaw and orthodox boxer's legs tangled, but for the most part, she was able to score, and often without reply. Such was her movement as illustrated there.
Yeah, shoot, Kukovic's movement was exceptional on the back foot and on the front foot, counter-punching, moving around the ring. I just hope Karim isn't too down about that loss, because she's got so much more to learn. I could just tell from the way she was boxing through the rounds, changing up the tactics and what she was doing. We'll definitely see a lot more from Karim.
So there's how she did it. Sara Kukovic taking all three rounds for all five scoring judges. 30-27 across the board. And there's confirmation of progress through to the quarterfinals for the reigning national champion of Serbia. Now one win away from securing an Olympic quota place.
Ring B. Winner by points, unanimous decision. In the red corner, represented Thailand. Ring A, bout number 412, women's 54 kilograms. In the red corner, representing Canada, Delgado's athlete. In the blue corner, representing Azerbaijan.
Our next contest in the women's 54 kilogram division between boxers from Canada and Azerbaijan. Oh, there is Scarlett Delgado, 28 years of age, is the woman from Brampton in Ontario. Delgado preparing for her second contest, having received a bye in the round of 64, 4-1 split decision winner in her previous contest. Her opponent, Zeynab Rahimova, 20 years of age, from the Azerbaijan capital of Baku. So they're the five scoring judges then. They hail from Chinese Taipei, Great Britain, Argentina, Tajikistan, and Fiji. The 10-point must system in effect. One boxer must score 10. Mr. Kim Jong-jin of the Korean Republic is the referee. Just checking the equipment of Rahimova. You see Rahimova's previous result in a round of 32, stopping her opponent from Ethiopia. She too received a bye in a round of 64. Here's confirmation of the sport. 4-1 split decision victory over Anna Svensson of Sweden, earned by Scarlett Delgado.
Representing Argentina, Robles Sofia Vigarella. In the blue corner, representing USA, Patricio Sheridan. Referee Miss Tampu Nelka Shiloma, Sri Lanka. Judge 1, Pakistan. Judge 3, Bulgaria. Judge 4, Romania. Judge 5, Philippines.
So we're underway then. This is 54 kilogram action for women. We are in the round of 16. The boxers one win away from the quarterfinals. Remember, it's the winning quarterfinalist who will progress through with a quarterfinal place at this weight. And the boxer wearing red, Scarlett Delgado, scoring effectively to both body and head, particularly with that backhand, which is right on the money once again. Her opponent, Zeynep Rahimova, just being outworked over the first 30 seconds of this opening round. Both boxers enjoying their second bout of this boxing Road to Paris event. Nice left jab landed from Rahimova, but look at that slapping left hand landed by Delgado, who then switched her attack down to the body. Not quite track shoes, but low-cut boxing shoes in white. Remember, Iron Mike Tyson out of Brooklyn, New York, used to favor that style of boxing boot in black. And she's not quite the same flat-footed destroyer, but she has found her range terrifically as she lands a half hook, half uppercut with that left hand in that coming together. Rahimova just up on her toes, trying to maintain a gap, but Delgado into range once again and scoring to the body before bringing the right hand up to the head. So Rahimova trying to establish her back foot boxing here, and she did have success to both body and head during that trade-off. But Delgado, there she's put on the end of a reverse 1-2 from Rahimova. But Rahimova, she's having success with her back foot prowess, but as a back foot boxer, she's got to indeed come forward sometimes, or at least hold her feet. And there she did land a good right hand followed by a left hook. And so Rahimova getting herself into this contest at the halfway stage after being outscored, outboxed and outworked in the first 30 seconds.
Yeah, Rahimova really, really struggled in the first half of this round just to get her feet settled, get her punches going, because Delgado has just been relentless. I mean, her right hand, her backhand has almost been used as a jab, just coming in straight away, just over the top. Just like that.
Reverse 1-2, right hand first, followed by the left jab. Nice jab while spinning off the line from Rahimova, but Delgado with that backhand honey punch once again, catching the head guard of Rahimova. And look at Delgado work away, throwing Rahimova into the ropes and helping herself to a double right hand, body then head, and then more success in the space of center ring, punctuated by that flashing left hook. This is terrific work from Scarlett Delgado with 20 seconds remaining in this opening round. Rahimova has done a good job to get herself into contention as she lands a flashing left hook of her own. But Delgado, there's a right hand once again leading off her two-shot salvo as she tried to follow up with a left hook to the body. And there's a double right hand once again, just snuck home on the command of stop from Delgado. And again, scoring right hand followed by that half hook, half uppercut, reminiscent of her compatriot Donovan Razor Ruddock, who used to call that his smash punch when he ripped it up, half hook, half uppercut. Delgado's used that shot to terrific effect, and that is why she has swept the board 10-9 for a clean sweep of the cards. It's Samuel Maïs, the former Canadian super heavyweight, in the ring, issuing those instructions. Glasgow 2014 gold medalist. And you were at that Commonwealth Games, Nicola.
Yeah, I was.
One of your fellow gold medalists now passing on his wisdom and knowledge as the head coach of the Canadian national team. And my goodness, his charge boxed terrifically over the first 3 minutes.
It really, really did. Delgado was just using that right hand. It was like a homing beacon. It just could not miss the target. Just again and again, just bam, bam, bam. Beautiful boxing.
Rahimova did get herself into the contest, but she was outscored quite considerably by the accurate work of Scarlett Delgado. Both boxers out briskly to bring in round number two, and look at the change in approach from Rahimova. Onto the front foot, looking to make Delgado go backwards, and see how the Canadian operates when pushed back. There she would just put on the end of a stiff left jab by the taller Azeri opponent. And Rahimova has done, well, it's a notable change in approach as she has success with the reverse 1-2, with Delgado looking to re-establish the pattern that she laid down in round number one, where she was the front foot aggressor and invariably dictating the tenor at which this contest was fought. Four shot combination and then a screw shot left hand to a nat cluster of punches from Delgado. So Rahimova tried to begin the round pushing Delgado backwards, but Delgado has stood her ground, bit down on her gum shield, and is backing up Rahimova once again.
Rahimova really needs to get a tighter guard, especially in the middle. She needs to really tighten that guard up so she's not taking so many shots on the way in and the way out. And get behind that jab. Don't stand there and try and trade. Delgado has shown that this is where she's most comfortable.
Approaching the halfway stage of this second round, both boxers in their second attempt to qualify for Paris 2024. Scarlett Delgado was a quarter finalist at the multi-sport Pan Am Games in Santiago in Chile at the back end of last year. Rahimova went to the European multi-sport event, the European Games, as again, look at Delgado working away with that free left hand burst of shoeshine punches after the command of stop from Delgado. Delgado, so much ability and experience. Back-to-back America's Continental Championships at 54 kilograms, having picked up the second of those brace of titles in Cali, Colombia, adding to the one that she won the year before in Ecuador. And that's where her father hails from. And he was her first boxing coach, as is so often the case. Not in your case, Nicola, because you were doing training while your mum was doing aerobics.
Yeah.
But so many parents introduce their kids to the sport of boxing. That's the case with Delgado. Remember Peter Taylor and Katie Taylor, that combination. Joe Calzaghe and his father. Felix Trinidad and his father.
Lomachenko.
Richie Woodall. Yep, Lomachenko. On and on and on. That's Scarlett Delgado's scenario as well. My goodness, she's bringing that greater international experience to bear here. Rahimova, credit to her, she's trying to push Delgado backwards, and Delgado will know that she's been in a contest here in round number two, but such is her competitive spirit that when she has been backed up, she refuses to be backed up beyond a certain point, plants her feet into the canvas, and lets shots go from both hands. Beautiful counter, lead right hand, followed by that flashing left hook from Delgado. So credit to Zeynab Rahimova for trying to turn things around and make a good fist of it. But I think it's going to be a repeat of the scorecards returned in the opening round. Well, no, she's taken it for judge number four from Tajikistan, Zeynab Rahimova. So getting it for that particular observer, but trailing 20 points to 18 for judges 1, 2, 3, and 5. But credit to Rahimova for trying to do something different after being outboxed in the first round pretty comfortably by the reigning two-time America's Continental Champion.
Yeah, Rahimova really did. She really dug deep there at the last part of the round. I think in this round coming out, she needs a little bit more head movement, get the guard a little bit tighter, and not allow her Canadian opponent to just rush her and walk in and walk her down.
So into the third and final round we go. Zeynab Rahimova took a share of the second round, judge number four preferring her work, but she's trailing 20 points to 18 for four of the five scoring judges. She was outboxed by the effective aggression Scarlett Delgado produced in the first 3 minutes stand-up. Rahimova did something different in the second round, just like that. Reverse 1-2, that catches Delgado cleanly, backs her up, but look at Delgado answering back almost immediately with those shots to the body. And that is a hallmark of a competitive individual. You tag me, I'm going to get you back instantly in a bid to try and even things up.
Yeah, Delgado's boxing really, really well here. The right hand just cannot miss the target.
She scores with a left jab, and this time it's a conventional 1-2 set up by the jab, but there's a right hand over the top without the jab laying the foundation for it in that instance. She's been really active, and look at that. She almost held up the left jab as okay, say, watch this, here comes the left, and boom, it still crashed and found a home on the chin of Rahimova. Terrific right hand once again, but that's countered by a shot by Rahimova. Rahimova, credit to her competitive spirit, because she's still in there firing away and competing. But Delgado with a far greater depth of international experience, and that experience has been on display here as she lands another right hand without reply before the boxers fall into a clinch. And again, both boxers displaying that stick-you attitude. No friendship in the ring at the moment, pushing one another off beyond punching range before the intervention of the ref. And now they get back to action at center ring. Good burst of punches to the body, punctuated by a right hand from Delgado. And again, left-right combination. And Rahimova Again, biting down on that mouthpiece and continuing to compete, making it a trade-off. She came out second best, but at least she is competing to make it an exchange instead of punches without reply from Delgado.
Yeah, Rahimova is giving it a really, really good, really good effort. I think she just needs to tighten up that guard and not let Delgado have it all her own way. Really, really push for this.
And she's doing exactly that as she bids to fire back, working away to the body with that burst of punches.
That's it.
Terrific left jab. It caught Delgado as she was coming in. It was almost as though Delgado was shaping up to throw a leaping shot in the manner of former Olympic champion Floyd Patterson, the first man to regain the heavyweight championship. And as she was in midair in there for no resistance, the shot just stopped her in her tracks. Terrific lead shot from Rahimova. Can she capitalize on that in the closing seconds? But Delgado now showcasing her movement, managing the clock, maintaining the gap, twinkle-toed movements of the lateral variety when she's been a front foot walk down merchant for the majority of the contest. And that's a very impressive display indeed from Scarlett Delgado, the reigning two-time national continental champion of the Americas, showcasing all of her skill and experience at the expense of 20-year-old Zeynab Rahimova of Azerbaijan. A very good display indeed. And that will take Scarlett Delgado through to the quarterfinals. We're just awaiting official confirmation. And when we see the bracketology, that round of 16 will show Sarah Kirkovic, a talented teen from Serbia, will be her opponent in the next round. And what a contest that promises to be.
That's going to be
Delgado with her front foot aggression. Kirkovic with her beautiful movements. Here's the official announcement.
Boys, unanimous decision.
So Scarlett Delgado absolutely elated at having been declared a unanimous points decision victor over Zeynab Rahimova. Rahimova, credit to her. Outpointed in the first round unanimously, tried to do something different in the second, but she was met, matched, and indeed bettered by Scarlett Delgado, who just showed her greater depth of experience against her 20-year-old opponent.
Yeah, Delgado boxed beautifully. The right hand just couldn't miss. It was a shame for Rahimova because, you know, if she'd have just had a tighter left hand, a lot of those right hands wouldn't have landed. But there's going to be an exciting competition next out for Delgado. I can't wait to see that one.
So after Rahimova took round number two for the judge from Tajikistan, judge number four, Delgado responded to sweep the board in the third and final round, giving her that unanimous points decision verdict over Zeynab Rahimova. That secures her passage through to the quarterfinal stage. And she now one win away from earning that Olympic quota place in the women's 54-kilogram division. And look who awaits. It's the 2022 World and European Youth Champion, Sarah Kukovic of Serbia, who is a wonderful mover laterally around the perimeter of the boxing ring and against the front foot aggression of Scarlett Delgado. That promises to be quite a mix of styles. That contest scheduled 2 days' time on Monday in the afternoon session.
Body 2024 qualification bout. Women 60 kilograms.
So next we move into the women's 60 kilogram division. And this is a division where only the winning semi-finalists and a third place box off winner will go through. We're at the semi-final stage in this contest between boxers from Slovakia and the Netherlands. And there is 23-year-old Miroslava Jedinakova. Jedinakova seeking to become the first ever Slovakian boxer at the Olympic Games. Her opponent is from the Netherlands, 20. And that is Chelsea Heijnen. They're the five scoring judges. Mr. Emmanuel Valentin of Puerto Rico is our referee. They're the previous results.
Bout number
Heijnen.
26. Paris 2024 qualification.
Fourth bout of the tournament, starting a contest in the round of 64.
In the red corner,
decision victories in the last two contests for Jedinakova. Two beginning her campaign in the round of 64.
Sadiko Gojeda. Referee is Alan Campbell, USA. Judge 1, Ukraine. Judge 2, Iran. Judge 3, Korea. Judge 4, Poland. Judge 5, Morocco.
So we're underway then, this semi-final action in the women's 60-kilogram division. And this a division where semi-final winners and a third-place box-off winner will go through with a quota place to Paris 2024 in 140 days' time. So not quite the last chance saloon, as the taller figure, Miroslava Jedinakova of Slovakia, seeking to become the first female Olympic boxer from Slovakia, scoring terrifically with straight punches against a more compact opponent, and that is Chelsea Heijnen of the Netherlands. She keeps seeking to become the first Netherlands boxer to secure an Olympic quota in this Paris 2024 cycle. They didn't get any through the continental route at the European Games in Krakow last summer. And that is why she's out onto the front foot, but she's been picked off as she's advancing by terrific shots like that. The reverse one too, and the left hand was stuck home like a broom handle. Terrific work by Jedinakova.
Beautiful jab there from Jedinakova.
She's being pushed backwards by Heijnen. She's snaking out those long, straight punches to catch the advancing boxer wearing blue.
Heijnen's got the right game plan, though. She needs to get inside that reach of Jedinakova. Just getting a little bit tangled there.
Both boxers in their second attempt to qualify for Paris 2024, having competed in the multi-sport games. Good left jab from Jedinakova, countered by a left hook from Heijnen. Again, given the contrast in styles, that's a terrific left jab on entry from Heijnen, really jolting the head back of Jedinakova, who's trying to long bridge her opponent by holding those hands out, but Heijnen used quick feet to get inside those long arms and score with a jab of her own. And the jab isn't just about who has the longer arms, the jab is about timing, and Heijnen timed that lead left hand beautifully on that occasion. But now Jedinakova getting back to her own long lead left. Good jab once again from Heijnen to the chest, and then a left-right combination catching Jedinakova on an open chin.
Yeah, Heijnen is really starting to find a range now. Getting inside the long, rangy jab of Jedinakova. It's starting to get pretty tasty in there.
So Jedinakova, given her dimensions, doesn't seem particularly well suited to inside work. Nice left jab from Jedinakova, because at long range, she's demonstrating that she's a wonderful exponent of the jab. But Heijnen's jab has been effective. She's used quick feet to get herself into range, but there, look at her, fed another left jab from Jedinakova. Terrific opening round. It was a blistering start from the woman in red. Heijnen responding in the middle of the round. And that is why we have seen a split verdict returned. The mid-range jab of Chelsea Heijnen edging it over the long-range jab of Miroslava Jedinakova. A 4-1 split in favour of the boxer from the Netherlands.
Yeah, I think that's quite accurate. Heijnen really, really came... She started off slow, found it a little bit difficult to find a range against her taller opponent. But once she established that jab, as you can see there, the jab was the key, and then she was able to go work to the body and start landing those combos on the inside.
Again, the example of the punch picking from Heijnen, and her jab was really stiff and strong once she found a range with it. And Jedinakova doing a bit to get back on terms. So into the second round then, both boxers out to centre ring, looking to establish their lead left straight away. Each boxer with plenty of multi-nation and indeed domestic success under their belts. Heijnen actually started in the sport of rugby and switched to boxing. Coming from the sport of rugby, she'll at least be used to physicality. Because that's no sport for shrinking violets either. Not a combat sport, but as physical as it gets in terms of team sport. Nice right hand from Jedinakova.
Yeah, that was nice from Jedinakova there. I think she needs to get back to her boxing. Get behind that long, lovely left jab that she was using in the first round. To try and stop Hydrogen walking her down.
Hydrogen just on the edge of range, kept the attack going. And as Jedinakova landed, there was a reverse 1-2. That was a cracking combination from Hydrogen. Far more potent and thereby getting the better of the exchange. Jedinakova in this every second of the way. But Hydrogen just giving the impression that she's getting the better of the trade-offs.
Oh.
Nice left-right from Jedinakova. Hydrogen cutting a composed figure, and again with Jedinakova in a wide-legged stance, her balance just seemed to betray her a little bit, and as her knees were almost down in a squat position, she was picked off and her head was jolted backwards, just as it was by that left jab from Hydrogen. And there's the left jab once again. So can Jedinakova re-establish the distance that she began the contest with? See the two boxers fencing with the lead hands. There's a left jab on the disengagement from Jedinakova, followed by a right hand over the top. Hydrogen made to miss as she wound up with the backhand.
And that was better from Jedinakova. Just using her range a little bit more. She just needs to, as her opponent comes in, take a little step back. Oh, just as she tried to do there, to land the right hand and let her opponent walk straight onto it.
So Jedinakova spoken to again about keeping her head up. Beautiful right hand as she walked into the front door, Hydrogen, and helped herself to that right cross success. So Jedinakova's defense proving a little bit porous, and Hydrogen taking advantage as she looked to do there, but the shots went long. And again, just illustrating the fact that Jedinakova, with those long raking arms, not really suited to inside work because it just takes so long to retract them, wind them up, and then uncoil them. But she is still trying to find a home for her straights. Closing seconds of the second round. So, another competitive 3 minutes of boxing, but Hydrogen with the more solid shots throughout. And that is why she is leading 20 points to 18 for four of the five scoring judges. Judge number two preferring the work of Jedinakova in both of the completed rounds. So, Hydrogen in a strong position with 3 minutes remaining, eschewing the stall, electing to remain on her feet in between rounds, waiting the bell to begin the third, and she's in a strong position.
Yeah, she's in a very strong position going into this round. Struggled in the first round to find her range, but in this second round, she really let her punches go, got behind the jab, got inside her taller opponent's range, and started making a mark. Jedinakova's got a lot of work to do in this round.
So into the third and final round then, in this battle between women with claimed national championships, Chelsea Hydrogen of the Netherlands with a backhand and then keeping the attack going to catch her opponent with an overhand right. There you see that stiff left jab from Jedinakova just inconveniencing Hydrogen. Hydrogen, 2022 World Championship bronze medalist at 63 kilograms.
Oh.
And Jedinakova losing her footing. Again, this is favouring Hydrogen, even though the distance appears to be favourable for Jedinakova. But look at how Hydrogen was able to close the gap on quick feet and pepper her opponent with straight punches once again. But when it's beyond punching range, the clock will continue to elapse as Jedinakova lands a good right hand. But the clock continuing to elapse means that Jedinakova is running out of time. She goes in pursuit of the massive final round that she needs to get back on terms and take this to count back.
Yeah, Jedinakova's really struggling. with her opponent on the inside. I think that's what's been letting her down, because her arms are so long. It's very hard, like you said, to get her arms back in there to be able to do some punching.
And then when it's been at long range, we're given their statures. That is Jedinakova's preferred territory. Heijinen's timing has been such that she's been able to just draw the slightest of responses, a twitch, a feint, and then get into range on quick feet, score with her own straight shots, and then they find themselves in this position, which takes seconds off the clock. Referee has to intervene, and then the pattern begins all over again. So can Jedinakova begin to lead off with a retractable left jab as she did at the start of the contest? But once Heijinen found her flow and her timing, well, that is the type of offensive success she's been able to produce on a regular basis. There, Jedinakova having some success during a trade-off, but there hasn't been enough of it from the Slovakian boxer's point of view.
Yeah, no, there hasn't. Then there really needed to be more. And Heijinen, to her credit, has found the opening on the inside, just slipping slightly inside the long-range jab. And, oh, straight down the middle, just like there.
And again, look at this. It starts beyond range, but then with just a quick movement of the feet and terrific timing, Heijinen finding the target repeatedly with her straight shots, despite Jedinakova possessing the longer reach. Brings to mind the prowess of Emil Griffith, the former welterweight and middleweight champion of the world. Up at middleweight, he was invariably shorter than everybody, every boxer that he faced, but he was seldom out-jabbed. Such was his timing. There's a terrific right hand over the top from Jedinakova. Strong conclusion to the contest for her. But and you can see the contrast in emotions. The Netherlands corner absolutely elated, because they will know that this victory will send Chelsea Heijinen through to the Olympic Games with a quota place. And in stark contrast, look at the bitter disappointment that is evident on the face of Miroslava Jedinakova. But she can't be too despondent, because remember, at women's 60 kilograms, there is a third place box off. The third place box off winner will join Chelsea Heijinen in Paris 2024 with a quota place. Let's get official confirmation of this one. Likely to be a split decision verdict for the woman in blue, 4-1.
We are qualified for the Olympic Games, Paris 2024. Winner by power split decision in the blue corner.
And there is confirmation of a points victory for Chelsea Heijinen of the Netherlands, taking it on a 4-1 verdict over Miroslava Jedinakova of Slovakia. And that elation over in the blue corner is because Chelsea Heijinen has just punched her ticket through to Paris 2024 by earning a quota place for the Olympic Games, where the boxing tournament begins in 140 days' time. Mission accomplished for Chelsea Heijinen. A terrific performance, able to negate the greater range and reach of Miroslava Jedinakova, and she has earned that precious quota place for the Olympic boxing tournament in Paris later this summer. That is how she did it, taking the final round unanimously, but her timing was absolutely sublime during the course of that contest to negate the longer arms of Miroslava Jedinakova.
Yeah, I really liked the adjustments that Heijinen made in the ring after the first round. Just the slight little slip to the side, then letting her punches go down the middle. And letting her taller opponent's range just go straight inside the jab, and her punches were just whistling by her head. Beautiful.
Well,
boxing.
As disappointed as Jedinakova was, you see, that quota bout bracket is where Jedinakova will drop down to. So she's got to pick herself back up, take the positives from that performance. Remember, she ended the contest with a long, strong right cross, and at the start of the bout, her jab was working beautifully. So all the disappointments over this first Olympic qualification opportunity being taken or being not going her way, that has got to be put to the back of her mind, and her and her team have got to refocus and come again, because it's the two winning semi-finalists and the quota bout winner who will earn quota places at women's 60 kilograms.
in their red corner.
So next we move into the 66 kilogram division for women, and this is a contest between boxers from the Netherlands and Uzbekistan. And there is Luna Amaro Bilu. We saw her in action yesterday, Nicola. Just 20 years of age, a woman from The Hague, against Avbakor Kamidova of Uzbekistan. A woman from Samarkand, 23 years old. They're the five scoring judges then who will score this one. They come from Hungary, Algeria, the Korean Republic, Fiji, and Canada.
Ring B, half number 427, women's 66 kilograms.
Our referee is Mr. Sean Reese of the United States of America. The officials all drawn randomly and neutrality is assured. One of the you see the previous results of Navbakor Kamidova of Uzbekistan, a unanimous point decision winner over opponent from Greece. That's what we commentated on yesterday, Nicola.
Yeah.
Very good display indeed from Kamidova. As for Luna Amaro Bilu, she too a unanimous point decision victor over Emilie Sonvico of France at the round of 32 stage. So we're underway then. This is action in the women's 66 kilogram weight class. It's the round of 16. The winner, or the boxers two wins away from earning an Olympic quota place. It's between boxers from the Netherlands and Uzbekistan. The boxer wearing red, who's just been put on the end of a razor sharp 1-2, is Luna Amaro Bilu, 20 years of age, from The Hague, reigning national champion of the Netherlands at 66 kilograms. Her opponent wearing blue, just operating behind a low held left hand. She was put on the end of a stiff jab there as Bilu was able to back away and employ the layback. And that is the reigning national champion of Uzbekistan, Avbakor Kamidova. Reigning world championship bronze medalist in New Delhi, India, at the global tournament held in the Indian capital last summer. This a contest between two very good box punchers. You can see it's a game of cat and mouse just on the edge of range. It was Kamidova who broke the deadlock and had the better of the trade-off that ensued. Bilu, aware of that, and that is why she kept the attack going, walking Kamidova back towards the ropes. Beautiful work to the body from Bilu. Made Kamidova miss with a left jab upstairs, dipped at the knees and fired in a fusillade of straight punches just above the belt line of Kamidova.
Yeah, Bilu's settling into this fight a little bit faster than Kamidova today.
And again, this is the nature of tournament boxing. Nice counter left hand from Kamidova after Bilu's roundhouse right was inaccurate, but that altogether shorter right was on the mark, as was that straight right hand lead out of the orthodox stance to the body of Kamidova. Beautiful left hook from Bilu, catching Kamidova as she was coming in. Kamidova just having to fiddle with her head guard. 2 minutes gone in what has been an intriguing opening round thus far. Look at the feinting on the edge of range from both boxers. Reverse 1-2 from Kamidova, landing with the right hand, followed by a left jab. Bilu trying to bustle her way out of that clinch as the two boxers come together. And Bilu busy once again with the roughhouse tactics. Slightly more compact figure, looking to impose her physicality at close range there.
Yeah, Bilu, at the start of the round, she was really headhunting, and she found it wasn't working, so she started going to the body, and it seemed to have found an opening for her. She's going body and then up to the head. Kamidova really needs to get behind that jab and not let her opponent just come inside and walk her down and get entangled like that.
See Bilu trying to dig away with her free right hand. She's a rough customer on the inside, is Luna Amaro Bilu. And there's a beautiful left jab once again. The right hand that preceded it was a little bit short. And now Bilu dropping her hands down to her knees, trying to draw Kamidova forwards. And Kamidova, well, I'm not quite sure why Kamidova's raiding her hands, because she helped herself to two straight punches after the bell had sounded. Or giving her the benefit of the doubt. Perhaps they landed or were launched as the bell was sounding. But Kamidova giving it across the board. Bilou perhaps a little unfortunate not to at least get a share of it. It was a very competitive first 3 minutes, with each boxer enjoying success in their preferred territory, but all five judges preferring the work of the reigning World Championship bronze medalist.
Yeah, that was nice work by Bilou. Kamidova started to get into it in pockets. When she found a raid like there with the backhand, she was boxing beautifully. I think in the next round she needs to come out. We need to see a little bit more of that. So finding a range straight away and letting her shots go.
Elshad Razilov, former Olympian, in the corner of Kamidova. Josh, one of the boxers, Josh Boatzi, beat en route to his bronze medal run. He's the man in the centre of the Uzbekistan coaching contingent. Outstanding boxer as Bilou scoring to the body once again with that jab. And then look at that exchange initiated by Bilou's left hook on the inside. And because she did concede the first round unanimously, I can only conclude that Bilou's work to the body not rewarded by the judges. As again, terrific straight punching by Kamidova, utilizing her greater range and reach to keep Bilou on the end of straight punches. But back to the body shots that perhaps weren't acknowledged by the judges. Sometimes they can be more difficult to score. Remember, judges sat in different positions. Now look at that, as Bilou was just bustling away to the body with shoeshine punches. Would the judge on the opposite side of the ring, behind Kamidova's back, will he or she have been able to see those? Open to question.
Yeah, body punches are quite hard to see for the judges, I feel, unless it's a really long straight right or straight jab to the body. But Kamidova's really coming into her own now. She's starting to let her punches go, letting the jab go, letting the backhand go.
And she's making good use of her assets of greater range and reach. And Bilou is enjoying the success to the body. There's a sneaky left hand to the body, but Kamidova had success of her own upstairs. And Bilou just in danger of smothering her own work here as she's desperately trying to free her hands and dig away with her left to the ribcage of Kamidova. Kamidova doing a good job as she drops down to the body and scores twice with her own right hand above the belt line of Bilou.
I think you can start to see the frustration from Bilou. She's starting to panic a little bit. She needs to relax, get back to her boxing.
Oh, that's a beautiful reverse 1-2. Right cross followed by a left jab from Kamidova. Then Kamidova dropping down to the body. And even though she took the first round unanimously, this is a far clearer round with 50 seconds remaining in favour of Kamidova. You see Bilou backing off. Kamidova not falling into a trap, and that is why she shrugged her shoulders. And when Bilou did get into her own mid-range, it's Kamidova who got the better of the trade-off. Arcing right hands and left uppercut fired underneath. So Kamidova into her groove now. Bilou, aware of that, tries to walk her opponent down and does have some success on that forward foray. But Kamidova straight back into the mix with a left jab, right cross.
Well, Kamidova's really working well now. She's getting very comfortable.
Bilou just pounding those gloves together in frustration. Closing seconds of the second round. And again, pays the price of a flashing right cross and a left hook on the disengagement in between those two shots from Kamidova. There was a burst of successful punches to the body from Bilou, but I think this is a really commanding round that is just being produced by Kamidova, and that is why she has taken it unanimously. Thought Bilou was a little unfortunate not to get a share of the first round, but there was clear daylight between the two in round number two, because Kamidova really began to control the distance effectively behind her long straight punches.
Yeah, she really did. Kamidova was working really well in that round. I think she started a bit slow in the first round, but she started to really open up in this second round, holding her feet, letting her jab go, letting her backhand go. And Bilou's really got it all to work for now. Started to get a little bit frustrated because she wasn't landing the way she was in the first round. She just needs to try and keep a cool, calm head and get back to her boxing, get behind that jab.
So, the third and final round underway. Luna Amaro Bilu is trailing 20 points to 18 for all five scoring judges. You can see her trying to work away on the inside. But to overcome that two-point deficit, she's going to need a massive final round. Credit to her. She's going in search of it.
Oh.
And that's a terrific shot once more. Kamidova. To keep her opponent occupied on the end of straight punches, slapping left hand before disengaging. Landed by Kamidova. Left hand managed to snake its way between the high-held gloves of the woman wearing red, as did that one. And even though they weren't solid jabs from Kamidova, I think they were landed with enough force to be point-scoring jabs. And moreover, they can be really irritating. It's like being pestered by flies. You keep getting touched up with feather-like jabs like that. But Kamidova is capable of sitting down on her punches and getting far more pop on them. You see her disengaging, moving laterally beyond punching range, and that will just allow the clock to continue to tick down. And the clock, as Kamidova steals a glance to her corner and Elshad Razilov, while the clock is very much the friend of Kamidova. There is a solid left hand from Bilou, but the clock is very much the foe of Bilou, because she's got to get something done in the final half of this final round.
Yeah, she really does. Kamidova's doing really well with the bout management there, just moving around the ring, trying not to engage too often, trying not to get too involved, because she knows she's got a very big fight coming up tomorrow.
Good work by Bilou with that burst of punches, ending with an overhand right. And credit to Bilou, she has never given up. Oh, there's a reverse 1-2, but Kamidova, I'm not quite sure who she's remonstrating with. Don't think there was a command from the referee. She's done that on a few occasions in this contest. But again, overall, she has managed to control the distance very effectively indeed. Nice forward foray from Bilou, where she did have success. Kamidova just tying her up to allow some seconds to tick off the clock once more. And look at her going walkabout beyond punching range. And Bilou will be more aware of the deficit that she faces than anyone. Live scoring will have seen her coaches communicate the state of the bout with her as she entered the third and final round. But such is the experience of Kamidova, reigning world championship bronze medalist and continental under 22 champion of Asia in 2022. That she's not going to fall into the trap that Bilou's trying to lay for her. And if Bilou wants to try and draw her in, instead Kamidova will go walkabout. Let enough punches go to keep the referee and the judges happy. But this has been a very clever display from Kamidova. And she, as the 10-second clapper sounds, will find herself just one win away, having progressed through to the quarterfinals, just one win away now from earning an Olympic quota place. And doesn't she know it? Acknowledging her performance by raising that right fist in triumph immediately. Elshad Razilov removing the head guard. And they must be really pleased with her boxer, because she boxed toward her very well indeed. Bilou gave it her best effort, but met an opponent with a greater depth of international experience, and she was able to bring that greater experience to bear in this round of 16 encounter.
Here come the results.
Ring A. The winner by points, unanimous decision, in the blue corner representing Uzbekistan.
So Navbakor Kamidova of Uzbekistan, now one win away from earning an Olympic quota place, having been declared a unanimous points decision victor over Luna Amaro Bilou of the Netherlands. Bilou never stopped competing with her bustling come-forward style, but Kamidova controlled the distance beautifully, particularly in the second round, made a terrific use of her assets of greater range and reach. And in the third round, while she went into bout management mode, disengaging regularly, staying beyond punching range, just as she did there after her success, but she brought all of her experience to the fore during the course of that three-round contest, and that is why she took all three rounds for all five scoring judges.
Yeah, Kamidova boxed really, really well there, used her assets and her abilities, staying at long range, not getting involved. Bilou, just as the rounds went on, she started to panic more and then started to rush her work, started to panic, and then she was smothering her inside work, which wasn't helping her. in that fight.
So there is confirmation of progress through to the round of 16 for Kamidova. And that contest will take place in 2 days' time on Monday in the afternoon session. That is when the majority of the Olympic quotas will be earned in 11 of the 13 weight classes that are being contested for men and women. That is when the quota places will be decided. And that's when the tournament will stop. So no medalists, no champions being awarded. Quarterfinals enough in 11 of the 13 weights, and that is when the tournament will conclude. And remember, over 600 boxers, 602 boxers from 113 National Olympic Committees entered. It's day 7 of the competition, and we've still got another 2 days to go. You can see it remains a two-ring operation, such as the sheer volume of bouts that we are getting through, and the boxers remain in pursuit of their Olympic quota place. Oh, there is Maria Moronta Hernandez of the Dominican Republic. 27 years of age is the woman from Santo Domingo, and she an outstanding boxer. Her opponent, Suzette Ramirez, from a boxing family, 22 years of age, from Mexico. Both of these women in action yesterday here in Ring A, and both were very impressive indeed. Here are the five scoring judges who will preside over this one. They hail from Puerto Rico, Chinese Taipei, Tajikistan, Great Britain, and Azerbaijan.
I'm really looking forward to this one, Ron.
Mr. Radoslav Simone of Slovakia is the referee, and again, neutrality of officials ensured by the random selection process from which they are drawn. So we take a look at the previous results of Moronta Hernandez. As for Ramirez, split decision victory over Crinuta Sibi of Romania. And again, her raiding, bustling attacks at short range, eye-catching indeed, very competitive individual.
There's going to be some bombs thrown in this. Don't blink.
So we're underway then. This is action in the 66-kilogram division. We're at the round of 16 stage. Winner progressing through to the quarterfinals. So both of these boxers currently 2 wins away from earning an Olympic quota place. The woman wearing red is Maria Moronta Hernandez, 27 years of age, from Santo Domingo. Her second attempt to qualify for Paris 2024 after a quarterfinal finish at the multi-sport Pan Am Games in Santiago, Chile last year. The woman wearing blue, who just scored with a good jab to the body, is Suzette Ramirez. She's the niece of former professional boxer Juan Carlos Ramirez, second place finisher in the Mexican Women's National Championships earlier this year. And this her first attempt to qualify for the Olympic Games. Didn't go to the multi-sport extravaganza, that is the Pan Am Games, at the back end of last year. Nice counter left hand from Ramirez, who is very calm. Lets Moronta Hernandez let her hands go, bobs and weaves away from the punches. You see how subtle that defensive block with the right glove was. Hardly any movement, but just a flick of her wrist caused the shot of Moronta Hernandez to be inaccurate.
Yeah, I like the way Ramirez is moving around the rings. Really tight guard, because she knows Hernandez box throws a lot of punches. She's just taking them on the guard, on the forearms, and not really letting a lot through.
Terrific work with the defensive gloves once again from Ramirez. And there she has the final word, landing her own 1-2. Moronta Hernandez does get through with a left jab on that occasion and drops down effectively to the body. The final left hook was a beauty as she turned her palm up to the ring lights here. Right hook around the corner may have snuck behind the left glove of Ramirez. The following left hook seemed to be blocked by the right glove of the boxer from Mexico wearing blue. But look at the contrasting styles. Moronta Hernandez on the back foot, sneaks through a left uppercut and a right hook around the corner. Beautiful work to the body once again from Moronta Hernandez, despite being pinned against the neutral corner turnbuckle. Spins out to the space of center ring, scores effectively with straight shots to the body of Moronta Hernandez. There Moronta Hernandez sneaks through a right hand twice at mid-range. And again, contrasting approaches making for a really intriguing first 2 minutes 20 of this first round. Beautiful work to the body once more. Left right upstairs, buffeted by the gloves and forearms of Ramirez, but the left hook to the body was a peach of a punch. And look at her go body hunting once again. She has her chin checked by a left hook after she perhaps stayed in there a little bit too long, maybe got greedy and drunk on her successes, and that is why we had the terrific trade-off. But Maronta Hernandez finding her range through this portion of the round, particularly to the body, because there's more subtle defensive work with the right glove from Ramirez. She's able to ward off the incoming fire aimed at her chin with terrific effect, but that the openings to the body have been spotted by Maronta Hernandez. And that was a terrific round of boxing. I only hope that the body work of Maronta Hernandez has been recognized and rewarded, and indeed it has, because after the defensive work of Ramirez was able to parry and block a lot of the incoming fire aimed at her chin, intelligently, Maria Maronta Hernandez dropped down to the body, and my goodness, didn't she have success with her body attacks?
Yeah, Hernandez really did, had some good success with her body attacks. She was going to the head, realized that that wasn't working. She needed a way to bring her opponent's hands down, started to go and connect to the body. And then as you can see, she comes back up to the head as her opponent's hands come down. Ramirez in this round for me needs to start letting her hands go. The defense is good. It's solid. It's sound. Now we need to see some work coming back at Hernandez.
So into the second round then. Maria Maronta Hernandez of the Dominican Republic has come out aggressively to begin this second round, pistoning out that left jab to both head and body. And just backing up Ramirez now, who for the entirety of the opening round was playing the flat-footed front foot stalker, creeping over the canvas of the boxing ring. But now it's an altogether more dynamic beginning by Maronta Hernandez. Now Ramirez gets back into a familiar posture on the front foot. But in the first 20 seconds, there's another lead left hook to the body. It's slammed home, followed by a right hand over the top. Maronta Hernandez finding her range beautifully as she goes in search of her second appearance at an Olympic Games, having made it through to the quarterfinals in Tokyo 3 summers ago. 2 wins away, remember, is how close the boxers are to achieving their Olympic dream. And Maronta Hernandez in the pocket, scoring with a left-right combination upstairs, kept the attack going, left-right, left, and the final right-left did get through. Darting jab to the body from Ramirez. And Ramirez appearing just a little bit one-paced here now. She's patient, but she's got to ensure that that patience doesn't turn into passivity. She's got to get busy with her own punch output. There she tries a counter right hand, got to counter right hand through twice, but either side of those backhand successes, she was touched up repeatedly by Maronta Hernandez, who got the better of the exchange.
Yeah, you can see now from Hernandez's work that it's paying off, the mixing up of the head and the body, the sound defense that Ramirez had in the first round is starting to come a little bit unstuck because she doesn't know where the punches are coming from. Ramirez needs to start to respond to this now and throw some punches back of her own. Get behind her jab. She's blocking her opponent's jab. We need to see something firing back now.
Yeah, she's trying to do so, but you can see how wide that scything hook was. Oh, that's a cracking right hand from Ramirez with Maronta Hernandez on the ropes. Maronta Hernandez back to center ring. That was a low blow. No complaints from Ramirez, but that was demonstrably below the belt. And now Ramirez with her own backhand success. But look at the work to the body from Maronta Hernandez, and it's bringing the hands down of Ramirez, who appears to have been hurt downstairs. That left her chin open. A right uppercut was turned underneath before Maronta Hernandez went back down to the body and then landed a jab on an open chin. What a terrific portion of the round for Maronta Hernandez, whose work to the body is paying dividends by bringing down the hands of Ramirez.
Beautiful work there by Hernandez. The body shots, you could just see Ramirez's hands just drop for a second. She really felt that. Oh, and again!
And again, these shots are right on the belt line. It's right in the eye line of the referee. He's happy that the blows are fair, but they appear borderline to me, and they are really testing the ab work and conditioning of Ramirez, who is being doubled over, her height being reduced by the second by these body shots that are being slammed in sumptuous fashion by Maria Maronta Hernandez. What a round, what an exhibition of body punching from the woman from the Dominican Republic. The second round in the book, the second round swept unanimously by the Tokyo Olympian. What a performance in round number two of aggressive, exquisite punch picking from Maria Moronta Hernandez, particularly to the torso of her opponent.
Hey, talk about saved by the bell rung. Ramirez really needed that bell there because the referee was taking a really good closer look at Ramirez there. And I could see some eight counts coming. I really could. She did well to stay on her feet there. But Hernandez's body work and head work, she just up to the body, then down to the body, up to the head. Just, oh, beautiful. She's just digging him in. Just shovel, bam, bam, bam.
So 3 minutes remaining in this women's 66-kilogram contest. Maria Moronta Hernandez of the Dominican Republic has taken both of the first two rounds unanimously, but Ramirez landing a good right hand early in this third round, keeping Maria Moronta Hernandez honest. Moronta Hernandez dropping down with a jab to the body, looking for the left hook to the rib cage once again. Good defense with the gloves once more from Ramirez to deflect the incoming fire aimed towards her chin. And again, wonderful movement in the pocket from Ramirez. She's got that side of the game down pat. But there's not been enough in terms of punch output to really trouble Maria Moronta Hernandez. And it's almost as though she's concentrating on one or the other. Good defense with the gloves and forearms from Moronta Hernandez before she again reaches for two long-range left hooks to the body.
I really like the way Hernandez came out, established the jab straight away, and found a timing for her opponent. And I don't think it'll be long before she's whipping those body shots back in.
So just over a minute gone in the third and final round. Suzette Ramirez needs a massive final round in a bid to get back on terms. Nice movement in the pocket from Moronta Hernandez after her offense was off the mark. Her defensive movement allowed Ramirez, or caused Ramirez to be inaccurate. There was a good single left hook to the body from Moronta Hernandez, followed by a right hand over the top. That's a solid right hook from Ramirez, and it checked the chin of Moronta Hernandez, clipping it cleanly. Didn't disrupt her boxing stance, but it certainly got her attention. Solid shot landed. There's another left hook to the body whipped in, and again it brings about a reaction from Ramirez in the form of bringing her forwards, causing her to jackknife at the waist.
Ramirez is doing really well to stay in this fight. She just needs to look to work a little bit more. Her defense has been pretty solid throughout the rounds. She's just lacking in that work. She needs to really start firing some punches. Get that jab going. Get the 1-2 going.
Nice lead right hand from up on her toes from Moronta Hernandez, now showing a different side to her game, gliding around the boxing ring in clockwise fashion, bringing the right cross into play. Inside the final minute now, she knows that she's got a commanding lead on the scorecards. And again, Ramirez proving to be comparatively slower foot. And when she increases the punching range, just look how long it takes Ramirez to get back into range. How long is that? 5, 6, 7 seconds? Before she was back into range to land her own leather. And that takes an awful lot of time off the clock when there was only 30 seconds remaining. Ramirez lands a right hand again, but there's a left hook off the ropes from Moronta Hernandez, who increases the distance between the two once more. Ramirez walks back into range and lands a right hand over the top. Credit to Suzette Ramirez. She has never stopped coming forwards, never stopped competing. But her comparative paucity of punch output will see her eliminated at this round of 16 stage, and going through to the quarterfinals will be the Tokyo Olympian and the reigning America's Continental bronze medalist, or the 2022 Continental bronze medalist, Maria Moronta Hernandez. A very good display indeed, really tested the body of Suzette Ramirez with some wicked body punching. Again, body language so instructive. I think Suzette Ramirez knows that this contest isn't going to go her way. Beneath the bandana, Maria Moronta Hernandez making her way to center ring, and her face on a picture worth a thousand words. Here's the verdict.
The winner, my points, unanimous decision in the red corner.
And there is confirmation of a unanimous points decision victory for the Tokyo Olympian, Maria Moronta Hernandez. She goes through to the round, to the quarterfinal stage, and is now one win away from becoming a two-time Olympian. Nice to see that respect between the boxers and the opposing coaches. And we will see Maria Moronta Hernandez again on Monday when she boxes in the quarterfinal against Kamidova of Uzbekistan. But there was the cracking right hand landed from Ramirez, and that is testament to her competitiveness, because she never gave in, even though she was outboxed and indeed hurt down to the body on several occasions. She remained committed to her task, never stopped pursuing Maronta Hernandez, but Maronta Hernandez boxed very well indeed and then saw the bout over the line with effective fight management, taking all three rounds for all five scoring judges. And it's through to the quarterfinals, and thereby one win away from an Olympic quota place for Maria Maronta Hernandez of the Dominican Republic. Suzette Ramirez, I'm sure we will see again. The 22-year-old, very talented boxer. And even though she's yet to claim a national title in Mexico, her talent's undeniable.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the way Ramirez was taking those body shots, and it's really hard. You know, you can get up from a headshot, but a body shot, you take too many of those and it really does zap your energy. So she did well to stay in there. Hernandez, I'm really excited about this girl. I think she's going to do amazing. I can't wait to see the next fight. It's going to be awesome. Make sure you guys see this. You'll love it.
Next, we move into the women's 75-kilogram division.
Number 416, women's 75 kilograms. In the red corner,
it's a contest between boxers from Kazakhstan and Turkey.
In the blue corner, representing Turkey, Isilda Buzra.
There is Valentina Kalzova, 28 years of age, from Astana.
USA, just 3, Taipei, just 4, Sweden.
And her opponent, 21-year-old Busra Isildar, from the Turkish metropolis of Istanbul. There are five scoring judges presiding over this one. They hail from Canada, the United States of America, Chinese Taipei, Sweden, and Algeria. Manuel Villarino of Argentina is the third person in the ring as our referee. And this action in the round of 16 at 75 kilograms, 30 boxers making up this particular weight bracket, and thereby the tournament beginning in the round of 32. First bout of the tournament for Valentina Kalzova. As for Isildar, she earned a unanimous point decision win over Ingrid Maldonado of Ecuador. It's day seven. It's the first time Valentina Kalzova has stepped into the boxing ring. It's been a long wait for the reigning world championship bronze medalist to get her campaign underway. That's right, this is about for a second bout of the tournament. So two talented boxers facing off in this round of 16 encounter in the 75-kilogram division. Four figure wearing red upon her toes is Kazakhstan's Valentina Kalzova, reigning world championship bronze medalist at 75 kilograms, adding to the bronze that she won the year before at 70 kilograms in Istanbul. Her opponent is the reigning European under-22 gold medalist at 75 kilograms, and that is Busra Isildar of Turkey. So two incredibly talented boxers. You can see both of them tall at the weight, very little in it. If you believe the tale of the tape, Isildar 2 centimeters taller, and that must be something of a rarity for Valentina Kalzova, who stands at 1.74 meters. Isildar listed at 1.76. So for Kalzova to be the shorter boxer at 75 kilograms must be something of a new experience for her, but there she got through with a beautiful left jab.
Kalzova is just finding a range, I think, here. Zelda's doing really well on the wide range, long range hooks, and the backhands.
So just beyond the halfway stage, of this opening round. Sildar made to miss. Kalzova stepping in with a lead right hand. And again, beautiful movement from Kalzova. Mentioned the fact that she's the slightly shorter of the two boxers. Isildar enjoyed tremendous success in the youth ranks, up at 81 kilograms and 81 kilograms plus. So she's come down in a bid to pursue her Olympic dream, because this is currently the heaviest weight class for women on the Olympic program. No 81, no 81 plus, 75 kilogram, the biggest weight for boxers. So even though she's the bigger athlete naturally, Kalzova, who's enjoyed success down at 70 kilograms on the global stage with that 2022 World Championship bronze, she's going to be using her attributes of speed and agility against a naturally bigger boxer. And there you can see she's using them well. Quick feet, right hand without reply. Mr. Manuel Vellerino speaking to Kalzova about the infringement of following through with the elbow.
Isilda just needs to be careful because she's getting caught round the outside. She's swinging her, swinging her punches from so wide. It's given her opponent, the opportunity to come inside the inside of her punches and catch her with a right hand.
Closing seconds. Again, sharper punch picking evident from Valentina Kalzova at the expense of Isildar. And for what it's worth, I happen to think that this woman did the better boxing in the opening round. Live scoring, we'll see how the five scoring judges ruled it. And it's a 4-1 split in favor of Kalzova. Isildar taking the round for judge number 3 from Chinese Taipei.
Yeah, I agree. I agree with that scoring. Kalzova boxed really well there. Isildar was just leaving herself open, swinging her punches very wide. And Kalzova was doing really well, just coming on the inside of the punches as she was trying to swing, as her opponent was trying to swing her hooks around the outside of her gloves. Isildar needs to, in this second round, work on straightening up her punches, going straight down the middle. It's the fastest way to your target.
Into the second round then. Valentina Kalzova was a quarter finalist at the Asian Games and Hangzhou at the back end of last year. I was ringside to commentate on that tournament. Was eliminated by China's Li Can at the quarterfinal stage. Again, establishing that lead left hand and is keeping the movement going. And Isildar reaching for punches. They're slower in comparison, but you can see from the breadth of her shoulders, even though they're the same weight class at 75 kg, you can see Isildar giving the impression of being a physically bigger athletes, even though they will have both made weight throughout the course of this tournament. You can see that Isildar is a boxer coming down from the higher weight classes. 81 and 81 kilogram plus success over the course of her career in the youth and junior ranks.
Isildar's just failing to bring her feet in when she's throwing her shots. That's why she's throwing her shots and it's not landing on the target. Kalzova's doing really well, counter-punching her as she falls over her front foot.
Kalzova's doing an outstanding job remaining up on her toes, employing the layback there to call Isildar to miss. Kalzova, given the natural size distance difference, I'm sure that Kalzova in her corner won't want to see her engaging in physical tussles with Isildar, as Isildar lands a good right hand over the top. And again, this could drain the energy of Kalzova and slow down the movement that she's used to such good effect in the first round and a half of boxing. She's back on her toes now, but grappling her weight and mauling on the inside is Isildar once again. Pecking jab fired out by both boxers, looking for a counter 1-2. Kalzova.
Kalzova's doing really well here. She's frustrating her opponent, Isildar. She keeps falling short with her punches because she's not bringing her feet into range before she starts to throw.
And again, with those tiny incremental movements, Kalzova doing an outstanding job, just increasing and decreasing the range on her own terms. plenty of energy being expended by Isildari. She goes in pursuit of her opponent. There she lands a shot during what turned into a trade-off. And again, made to miss by the impressive layback employed while under fire from Kalzova. Continuing to press is Isildar. Can she turn these into two and three phase attacks, pulling down on the rear of the neck of Kalzova in a bid to drain her energy further? In a battle between Olympic champions Joe Frazier and Muhammad Ali in the fight of the century at Madison Square Garden in March 71. You heard the coaches to watch Muhammad Ali ahead of the opening bell to not employ that tactic and pull down on the head of Smoking Joe. Well, Isildar tying it up, 19 points apiece for two of the three judges. A commanding position on three of the scorecards, 20 points to 18 for Valentina Kalzova. Had Isildar managed to tie it up for one more judge, then it would have been really interesting going into the final round. But now, trailing 20 points to 18 for three judges and only being level on two scorecards, is going to be a very difficult mission indeed for the reigning under 22 European champion. Conceded the first round on a 4-1 split. That's how she lost the second round, because of the distribution of scores. It is dead level on two of the scorecards. The other three scorecards favor Kalzova, 20 points to 18 for judges 1, 4, and 5.
Kalzova is in this third round now. Needs to try and keep it tidy, not get entangled, and let it get messy. That was better. Using the long-range punches.
And see, getting up on her toes, just slapping in with two shots, the left-right combination. And when she's beyond punching range like this, it is a very difficult task indeed for Isildar to close the gap. She possesses fantastic movement, but there it was Kalzova who was keen to initiate a clinch. Skipping around the perimeter of the ring, puts plenty of miles on the clock. And it is a draining exercise. Can she keep the movement going? As Isildar lands with a solid jab and another one. Kalzova up on her toes once again, just beyond punching range. But Isildar remaining in pursuit of Kalzova. But look at how long it's taking her to close the gap when Kalzova is able to keep the movement going. But here, she initiates and settles for another clinch, because again, to keep that dancing going around the ring is no easy task.
Yeah, it really isn't. Isildar just needs to speed up her feet now, and when she does get close enough to attack, not to smother her work, fall over her front foot. She needs to still be able to keep a little bit of distance, so she can land those straight long shots.
Again, she landed that clipping right hand when Kalzova's back touched the ropes. Up on her toes once again, but another single shot success for Isildar. There, Kalzova lands off the back foot. And Kalzova just killing the clock there, putting her opponent in a headlock. And the referee, hip to that infringement, speaking to her about it immediately. A minute remaining. Whoa. Nice right hand off the back foot from Kalzova, but Isildar landed during the trade-off as well. Again, those physical entanglements will probably be depleting. The energy levels off Kalzova further. There, Isildar landing a right hand after she was touched by a two-shot salvo from Kalzova. The final 40 seconds. And again, Kalzova feeling the efforts of her exertions here. Remember, it's day 7 of this Road to Paris boxing event, and it's the first time that Kalzova has been in the ring. And even though she's on weight, she'll be in shape getting out there in front of the fans, beneath the lights. That's a different exercise entirely to training and sparring. And she just appears to be feeling the pace or the efforts of her exertions, but she's going to make it through to the final bell. And she has managed the third round very effectively. Credit to Busra Isildar, she never stopped competing. But the superior foot speed of Valentina Kalzova was just enough for her to be able to maintain the gap for the majority of the third round. And she will be going through for my money. If you hear the word unanimous, it's beyond any question. I suspect it could be split depending on the distribution of the scores. But I don't have any doubt that Valentina Kalzova will be declared as the victor in this particular contest. Again, credit to Busra Isildar, just 20 years of age, the woman from Istanbul. I'm no doubt going to see her again. We may even see her in Thailand if she's selected by a federation, because I think her quest for an Olympic quota place comes to an end here.
The winner by points, split decision in the red corner.
You see, Isildar knew it, and that is why she nodded after she heard the word split decision. Valentina Kalsva sportingly making her way over to the corner of the boxer that she has just conquered, generously holding open the ropes through which Isildar will exit. We will see this woman again on Monday. She is through to the quarterfinal stage and now one win away, Valentina Kalsova, from appearing at the Olympic Games. The 2016 world champion at 69 kilograms. Now desperately close to an Olympic quota place at 75 kilograms after a very clever display indeed.
Yeah, really good there from Kalsova. Bout management was key in that last round. She didn't overexert herself too much and was able to just pick her points to victory.
So those how the scores, that's how the scores were distributed. Isildar taking a round for one judge in each of the three completed rounds, edging it overall for the judge from the United States of America, but a 4-1 split decision victory for the woman from Kazakhstan. So she goes through to the quarterfinal stage, now one win away from securing the Olympic quota place for Kazakhstan.
The winner by points, unanimous decision in the red corner representing Uzbekistan. Ring A, bout number 417.
So we will remain in the women's 75 kilogram division. Notice that we're not naming these weight divisions, and that's because that is no longer a factor in Olympic boxing or indeed Olympic weight-making sports, but we're in a 75-kilogram weight division for a contest between an athlete from the Boxing Refugee Team and the Korean Republic. Cindy Ngamba representing the Boxing Refugee Team. Suyeon Seong from the Korean Republic. The judges scoring this one hail from Fiji, Tajikistan, Hungary, Argentina, and the United States of America. Mr. Emmanuel Ferreira Valentin of Puerto Rico is the referee. Suyeon Seong, a split decision victor over Veronica Nakota of Hungary in the round of 32. As for Cindy Ngamba, she prevailing over Naomi Graham of the United States with a unanimous point decision verdict. You see, that's Lee Pullen of the Great Britain boxing team in the red corner, and that is Cindy Ngamba of the Boxing Refugee Team, actually lives and resides in Bolton in the United Kingdom. Regular up in the GB program, comes to the ring as the England Women's Winter Box Cup champion. It's her second attempt to qualify, having competed in the European Games last summer. Seong was also in action in her continental qualification event. Cindy Ngamba, often referred to as a secret weapon because for many of Britain's prominent fighters, such as Natasha Jonas, Lauren Price, Savannah Marshall, all use her during sparring. Absolutely outstanding talent is a woman who has won multiple English national titles in and around 75 and 81 kilograms. quarter finalist in the 2022 World Championships. And here she is in her second bout of this Boxing Road to Paris event. And she has come out blazing, bombing away with lefts and rights, putting Seong on the end of her jab. And it's a blistering start, a left hook at mid-range. Seong trying to box her way into the contest, but there's a right hand without reply. Left hook landed by Seong. And this one, a blazing start in this 75-kilogram round of 16 contest.
Really love the way Ngamba just got straight out there. Beautiful jab, followed by the backhand. Didn't mess about, didn't waste time. The jab is working beautiful. Oh, just punch picking is beautiful.
So inside, approaching a minute gone, Ngamba, one of the furious trade-offs. I think Ngamba has got the better of them, as evidenced by that reverse 1-2, followed by a conventional left-right. And again, straight shot successes for Seong, and then heavy punches down to the body. But the greater volume of combination punching coming from Ngamba, exchange of jabs there. And this is a furious firefight through the first minute of this opening round. Right hand success once from Ngamba once again, followed by a disruptive jab. Seong countered with a backhand, only to be met by a backhand, then a double jab, right hand through the middle, and the head of Seong being buffeted repeatedly. And that is why the referee has intervened to issue a standing 8 count. Ngamba simply non-stop punching of the most accurate variety, and she steps right back into the breach and is targeting the chin of Seong once again. Seong again employing to fight fire with fire, but she's being outscored, outpunched and outboxed by the incessant work rate of Cindy Ngamba of the Boxing Refugee Team.
Yeah, Seong just hasn't been able to get into this fight. She's just been getting caught with a barrage of punches.
So Ngamba continuing to set about her opponent with non-stop accurate attacks. And remember, in women's Olympic-style boxing, there is a limit of a maximum of 4 8-counts. There's a good right hand from Seong, but Ngamba, just disregarding it, gets onto the front foot, walks her opponent back to the ropes behind a fusillade of straight punches. This is terrific work from Cindy Ngamba, and having started at such a breakneck speed, the question is, assuming Seong survives it, will she be able to maintain it, Ngamba, as she lands another left-right combination, and then an uppercut, left hook to body and head. Absolutely incredible combination punching from Cindy Ngamba, and you can see why Britain's top boxers call her in for work, because she is capable of producing this type of offensive output. The second standing count of the round, 3 standing counts in a round, and the contest is curtailed. Left, right on the resumption, and Seong is in danger of being stopped in the first round, but she has made it through to the final, the concluding bell of round number one. What a round for Cindy Ngamba. Seong tried to keep herself in it, but she's been dominated, and that is why we have seen scorecards returned of 10-8 for all 5 scoring judges. Not just because of the standing counts, because as we've said, standing counts or knockdowns don't result in 10-8 rounds in Olympic boxing as it does in the pros, but it's the manner in which Ngamba went about her work. Seong trying to answer, but she was bettered and raised in every instance by combination punching like that.
Yes. Seong just really didn't. She came out for the first round, didn't really stand a chance there. Ngamba just... she just came out firing behind the jab, double jab, backhand, and then after that, she was like a tattoo gun, just pop, 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 pop. I honestly saw the referee taking a really good look at Seong, and I don't know whether this is going to make it through this second round.
So second round underway, and Ngamba beginning in the fashion that she ended the first, and again, Seong electing to try and fight with Ngamba. Seong, naturally bigger boxer. Well, I say naturally bigger, but you can see she appears to be thicker set. But Ngamba, supremely athletic, high volume and high ring IQ. That's the 3rd standing count. One more in women's Olympic style boxing, the contest will be over. But the referee, Mr. Valentin of Puerto Rico, has seen enough and has stopped this contest in the second round. And the incessant, accurate punching of Cindy Ngamba have seen her storm her way into the quarterfinals of the women's 75-kilogram weight division. And the woman representing the Boxing Refugee Team, who resides in Bolton, is now one win away from securing an Olympic quota place. An absolutely scintillating display from opening bell right until the tournament, the contest was concluded. It's the end of the tournament for Seong Soo-yeon. Cindy Ngamba, her confidence will be through the roof as she romps her way through to the quarterfinal stage with the 2016 world champion Valentina Kalzova awaits. So here's the verdict.
FSC in the red corner.
Oh, Cindy Ngamba acknowledging the crowd here with a salute. 35 seconds of the second round is all it took for her to bring about the third standing count of the contest, forcing the referee to call this one off inside the distance. Cindy Ngamba prevails RSC at the 35 second mark of round number two, and she goes storming into the quarterfinals where Valentina Kalzova of Kazakhstan awaits. What a contest that promises to be.
That's going to be a really good contest. I really love the way Ngamba came out, didn't mess about, got straight down to business, behind the jab, let the backhand go, and then let the combos just follow through from there, straight down the middle of the guard of her opponent.
So there's confirmation of the bout that will take place in the afternoon session on Monday. Valentina Kalzova against Cindy Ngamba of the Boxing Refugee Team. Ngamba, born in Cameroon, lives in the UK, receiving the tutelage from the GB coaches here in Northern Italy. But what a performance she has just produced. Absolutely sensational. And I hope the boxers preparing for the next bout are warmed up and ready to go, because this one has been curtailed early as we prepare to switch to the men's 63.5 kilogram weight division.
Had some really exciting boxing so far this morning.
Ring A of number 418.
So our next contest is between boxers from Poland and Turkmenistan.
Ruskovic Bartolomei in the blue corner, representing Turkmenistan.
Bartolomei Ruskovic of Poland, just 20 years of age, making his way to the boxing ring. His opponent is 23-year-old Safamat Odeyev of Turkmenistan. Our judges scoring this one hail from Slovakia, Puerto Rico, Canada, the Korean Republic, and Fiji. Mr. Sid Ali Mokhtari of Algeria is the third man in the ring as our referee. As we take a look at the previous results for Odeyev. Tournament began in the round of 64. We are underway. 63.5 kilogram contest. Ordinarily, this would have been declared, or in previous times, it would have been right around the light welterweight division. A sharp left jab landed by Odeyev. The boxer wearing blue, representing Turkmenistan, comes into the ring as their reigning national champion. They held their national championships for 2024 earlier this year. Participated in the World Championships last year in the continental event, the Asian Championships in Amman in Jordan. As for Bartolomei Ruskovic, into the ring as the reigning Polish national champion, 63.5 kilograms. He prevailed in their domestic championships last year. Skimming the ropes as he circumnavigates the boxing ring, both clockwise and counterclockwise, looking for a right hand, but it was defended by the glove of Odeyev, looking for a burst of shoeshine punches, not quite sure any of them were scoring shots before he disengaged beyond punching range. He You can see that Roskovic possesses terrifically quick feet, but he was inconvenienced by that crashing shot over the top, followed by a right hand to the body from Odaev.
Roskovic is just struggling here to just settle his feet and get into a flow. He's starting to try to do that now. But it's taken him a good half a round to really settle into this fight.
Odaev looking to score heavy shots to both head and body. See him scoring with a left right downstairs. Left hook upstairs is countered by a right hand from Roskovic. Odaev getting onto the back foot for the first time in the contest. Roskovic trying to press his way forward. Different approaches to the sweet science of boxing. Roskovic all speed and quick twitch up on his toes. Odaev looking to land heavy power punches out of a flat-footed stance. Bit of a standoff now as Odaev has just dialed down his front foot movement. Goes reaching for the body with straight punches and a sharp left jab followed by a right hand to the body from the man from Turkmenistan.
Odaev really trying to bully his younger opponent here. The power shots. Every shot he's thrown, I think, has been a power shot so far.
To left hand as Roskovic reached for a right hand while leaning to his left. And Roskovic got to be careful with the closing seconds. He looked for a quick-fisted flurry, but he was countered by a heavy single from Odaev. Roskovic, even though he's on the front foot, he looks for a right-hand lead. And again, in an exchange of backhands, it's Odaev that landed with more solidity. I think that's going to be a round in favour of Odaev. Just takes a pause before returning to his blue corner. Confirmation of a clean sweep of the cards from Odaev of Turkmenistan. And Roskovic, even though he came, looked as though he was coming forwards on occasion, I think he's going to have to be wary in his first season as a senior that he doesn't get accused of running or perceived as running, because he spent an awful lot of time up on his toes and on the back foot. And when he tried to get into range with his punches, he's on the move immediately before really committing to the shots. And in this Olympic style of boxing, you can't just punch with the arm. You've got to punch with sufficient force from the body for it to be rendered or considered as a scoring blow.
Roskovic just needs to be a little bit careful with his defence coming out in the second round. Odaev's quite strong, quite heavy-handed, it seems. And he doesn't want to get caught by those heavy punches. He's better with his defence.
To the second round, then. To hold centre ring and hold his feet more than he did in the first round. Roskovic behind the double jab and right cross. Again, right cross not landing with any particularly notable force. Credit to Roskovic for carrying out the instructions of his corner. There he lands a rapier-like right hand, countered by a right hand to the body from Odaev. Roskovic, a far less skittish figure here in round number two. And he appeared to be in round number one, just stealing a glance to his red corner during that intervention from the referee. Jab to the body from Odaev. Roskovic, credit to him, good right hand lead, looking for the left hook. And even though Odaev is only 23 years of age, he has a look of an athlete who has matured fully, not quite sure whether he would occupy any other weight classes. There's still something of a developmental look about the physique of Roskovic. He's in there competing in his quest to become an Olympian. Again, a burst of punches to both body and head from Roskovic. The left hand to the body was a nice shot as he reaches for a right hand over the top. Two shots shoveled in downstairs by Odaev with scoring blows. Again, Odaev intent to retreat to the ropes and trying to draw Roskovic in and unload his own heavy artillery.
It's better from Roskovic this round. He's taking the centre of the ring, taking more of control, pushing Odaev to do something different. Odaev needs to get back into this, slip inside those long punches and try and get his own shots off.
Odaev content to wait. Nice defence with his right glove to block the incoming left from Roskovic. You can see the blazing hand speed, left, right, left from Roskovic that the 20-year-old Polish boxer possesses. And perhaps Odaev would be better instructed to let his hands go with more frequency, because trying to go punch to punch with Roskovic, well, he's coming out a distant second best here, and so quick is the man from Poland that he's often getting away before Adaev can pull the trigger on his own shots. There you see a left right to the body, and then a left hook upstairs followed by a right hand from Adaev. And again, when he concentrates on his own offense rather than trying to match hand speed and boxing skill with Roskovic, he has far more effect and success from my perspective in the commentary box.
Oh.
That quick cluster of punches, I'm not sure they were landed with sufficient force to be considered scoring shots, as a double left hook, body then head. The hook that followed the body shot dislodged the mouthpiece. Terrifically quick, heavy left hand from Adaev. And that's him at his best, rather than staying on the edge of range and trying to match this man for hand speed. Good work to the body on a resumption from Roskovic. Adaev looking for the right hand over the top. Well, a much improved effort and approach for my money from Bartolomei Roskovic in that second round. But not enough. Getting back into the contest, took it for judge number one. Judges 2 through 5 all preferring the work of Adaev, who really did begin to let his hands go with bad intentions in the final 40 seconds of that second round.
Yeah, Adaev really did. He did well there. He saw his man had changed his tactics. Took a few seconds, about 40 seconds to adjust, and then started firing back. Managed to even dislodge his opponent's gum shield with an uppercut.
Super combination here, body then head. Good hands, Mr. Roskovic. Testament to his reflexes to catch the gum shield before it made contact with the canvas. We saw the referee make a gesture in his direction, because if that mouthpiece comes out on two more occasions, that will result in a point deduction. Into the third and final round then, and Roskovic out onto the front foot, trailing by 20-18 for judges 2, 3, 4 and 5 after 6 minutes of boxing. Rather surprised to see Adaev waiting and playing possum in this fashion to begin round number three, because they had most success when he was leading off rather than trying to play counterpuncher against this quick-fisted 20-year-old from Poland.
Yeah, he really did. I hope he doesn't fall into Roskovic's hands here and with the change of tactic.
Again, content to wait and trying to counter against Roskovic. When he's the initiator, for my money, he appears to have far more success, as both boxers spoken to about the requirement to keep their head up. Good double left hook. The final left hand to the body was a cracking shot. And again, you see the disruptive effect of that left uppercut right hook, knocking the 20-year-old off balance, as it does right there. And what? How was that secured? By Adaev leading off rather than waiting and attempting to counter.
Roskovic needs to get back to his boxing, get behind his jab, what he was doing really good at in the second round.
So Roskovic remaining over the front foot, and it's a stark contrast and considerable adaptation to the back foot boxing was trying to utilise in the first round. Adaev just reducing some of the power on his punches. You see him trying to pull down the defences of Roskovic before looking for a home for that right hand. Right hand over the top from Roskovic is a nice shot. And again, biggest bout of his career for Roskovic. He's acquitting himself very well indeed. So Adaev just entering bout management mode through this passage of the final round. He's engaging, getting beyond punching range. Roskovic with a nice left hook to the body. Then good defenses, followed by a right uppercut from Roskovic, looking for that shot again. And Adaev, well, perhaps he doesn't have many concerns or indeed much respect for the power of Roskovic. As again, he works with a three-shot salvo, ending with a left hook to the body. But these are point-scoring punches that Roskovic is able to get off. Infringement from Adaev for pushing his man beyond punching range. But again, he's leading 20-18 for 4 of the 5 judges. Roskovic, credit to him, has never been discouraged. Changed tactics after the first round, where his approach didn't yield any dividends at all, and he has never stopped competing. He's exerted an awful lot of energy in a bid to get himself back into contention. And again, the man strength of Sapomariat Adaev significant factor during the course of that contest, as indeed is his greater depth of senior experience. And it will be Adayev of Turkmenistan who will go through to round the next stage of the men's 63.5 kilogram tournament. So bitter disappointment for Roskovic, not going to make it through to the quarterfinals. Dayev now one win away from earning an Olympic quota.
The winner by points, unanimous decision, in the blue corner, defending Turkmenistan.
So Sapomariat Odayev of Turkmenistan, a unanimous point decision victor over Bartolomy Roskovic of Poland. Credit to Roskovic, adapted his strategy considerably after the first round. Really did give it a go, everything that he has at his disposal. But remember, he's just 20 years of age. This is the biggest tournament of his career, bar none. And hopefully, from his perspective, he'll be selected by his federation to go to the final Olympic qualification event in Thailand. But here, the round of 16 has been bested by the more experienced operator from Turkmenistan.
Yeah, Dayev boxed really, really well there. His man changed his tactics in the second round. He adjusted to that and then drew his man into a fight which he was more comfortable with in the third round to then take the points and take the bout.
So Adayev taking it unanimously. Roskovic taking the second round for judge number one. There is confirmation. The progression through to the quarterfinals for Adayev of Turkmenistan. Now one win away from earning an Olympic quota place.
Ring A. Bout number 418. Man's 63.5 kilograms. In the red corner, representing Venezuela,
the next contest, all South American affair, between boxers from Venezuela and Colombia. Jesus Kova, 23 years of age, approaching the boxing ring. The opponent, Jose Afara Fori, 26 years old. They're the five scoring judges from Tajikistan, Netherlands, the United States of America, Chinese Taipei, and Hungary, presiding over this one. Carlo Franchi of Italy is the referee. They're the previous results for Viafari Fori. Split decision victories on two occasions, in the round of 64 and round of 32. Unanimous point decision win over William Tanko of Slovakia, followed by a 3-2 victory over the man from Thailand in the round of 32 for Kova Romero. So we're in the 63.5 kilogram division. This contest between boxers from Venezuela and Colombia. The southpaw wearing red, Jesus Kova, 23 years of age. A marauding figure out of that southpaw stance comes to the ring as the reigning continental champion of the Americas, having claimed gold at 63.5 kilograms in the homeland of his opponent in that tournament in Cali, Colombia last year. As for the man wearing blue, that is Colombia's Jose Manuel Viafara Fori. Both of these boxers went to the multi-sport first continental qualifier in the Pan Am Games in Santiago with a quarter-final finish for the man in blue. but that below the Olympic quota securing requisite is a loss in the first preliminary round for the remaining for the reigning America's champion. So has an injury been sustained here?
It's cut.
Yep. Let's keep an eye on the referee, see if we can see how the cut has been secured. I think it's from a clash of heads. Right there. Well, what is that? Is it a forearm? Head clash? The doctor happy for the contest to continue. Nice right hand on the disengagement from Kova. It's a physical encounter, this one. It's a beautiful left hand from Viafara Fury, who has now switched to the southpaw stance. Left hand to the body from Viafara Fori. Generated terrific leverage on that shot, looking for the same punch once again. Trying to keep that injured eye out of harm's way. Kova, well, determined to get close, but there you see he's backed up by a stiff southpaw left. Remaining 40 seconds of this opening round. Well, the telegraphed overhand left from Viafara Fori. And again, was caught by an overhand left on... The boxers so committed to their attacks that in the event that they don't land, they invariably end up falling into one another, escaping off the ropes before momentarily losing his footing. And here's an example. Kova really going in search of that southpaw left, but because it was inaccurate, left uppercut not too far away from Viafara Fori. Plenty of clinching punctuating that opening round, a round in which this man sustained a cut after an accidental clash of heads during one of the frequent comings together. But it's Jesus Kova who's taken it on a 4-1 split. Didn't think there was that much between them, truth be told, because it was a very physical and often scrappy first 3 minutes.
Yeah, it really was. Kova was so keen and eager to get in there. He was sometimes smothering his work. But Foray did really well to try and keep his man at bay, try and keep him off guard. But it'll be interesting to see what happens in this second round.
Received confirmation that the cut endured by Viafara Fori has been caused by a clash of heads. Here's a leaping right hook from the more compact southpaw. That posture, chest to chest, knee to knee, is where they spent an awful lot of the first round. So can Viafara Fori, and who was a quarter finalist at the World Championships last year in Tashkent in Uzbekistan, losing to the evergreen Hovhannes Bachkov at the quarterfinal stage, and he get himself back into the contest having conceded the first round on a 4-1 split. Now there's beautiful punch picking behind a jab and left cross out of that southpaw stance. Mention the fact that Kova is the current America's continental champion at 63.5 kilograms. That's a title that Jose Viafara Fori held the year before when the tournament was held in Ecuador. Coming out in top spot on the podium, so two experienced international boxers, each in pursuit of their first Olympic quota place.
It's better from Fury there, just using the jab, trying to get his man to give him a little bit more respect. Kova's got the right tactics. He's not letting his man settle. He's not letting him find his rhythm. Coming forward, trying to slip inside those rows. That was better from Fury there. Trying to keep his shots long.
Getting on the inside and burrowing away to the body of his taller opponent is Kova. Hey. We're on the halfway stage of this second round, and again, when the initial jab was short, ending up in a bit of a tangle. The accuracy, not what either man is looking for it to be. But there he was accurate with a southpaw right and sharp left cross via Farah Fori. Over fairly tackles him around the waist. Look at that for a move. Squatting, roots to grass in a bid to try and break free of the clinch employed by via Farah Fori. That jab not too far away to begin that combination from via Farah Fori. Trying to use the space of the ring now, up on his toes and trying to lure Kova into his wheelhouse. Swinging away with a left uppercut, but he did get through with a follow-up right hand.
Oh!
Now, that's a rabbit punch for my money. That's a rabbit punch, and that is why Via Farah Fori simply cannot believe it. That was a forearm smash that seemed to catch Via Farah Fori around the rear of the head. That illegal, and I don't doubt that the blow sent him down to the canvas, but you simply can't hit a guy in the back of the head around the neck. And you see, that's why he's being issued a warning. So, the eight count, as we've said, the knockdown shot counted, but because it was a blatantly illegal blow, that point deducted from the scorecard of Jesus Kova. And that is officiating by the textbook from the Italian referee. Because you simply can't forearm smash your opponent like that and expect to receive reward for it. So the count was carried out, and then once the count was completed, then the infringement was penalized in the form of a point deduction. So whatever Kova has accrued in that round will be subject to minus one, and look at what it's done to the scorecards. Via Farah Fori leading 19 points to 18 for two for three of the five judges. 19 points to 18 the other way for Jesus Kova. And that infringement has really damaged his prospects here, because he is trailing on the scorecards of three of the five scoring judges. So Via Farah Fori in the third and final round just got to convince the judges who have him ahead 19-18. Here's the forearm smash in a bid to overturn this. Kova needs a massive final round to turn it decisively in his favour, or indeed take it to count back.
I think in Kova's rush to try and score, try and win the fight, he's smothering his work.
And that looks as though it's a final talking to in the direction of Via Farah Fori for his claiming around the rear of the head. It's an untidy contest, this one, between boxers from the neighbouring nations of Venezuela and Colombia in South America. Again, lots of misses being traded, and perhaps because it is something of a national derby, because they share that border in the north of the continent of South America, maybe the intensity and the emotion has just caused the quality to dissipate, and that happens so often in international sport. You're so keen to get one over your crosstown rival, your neighbour, that sometimes the quality and the strategy can often go out of the window. That could well have occurred here. There's a nice check right hand from Kova, who celebrates it by going walkabout. But remember, he's trailing 19 points to 18 for three of the five judges. He leads by the same margin for the remaining two judges.
Yeah, Kova really can't afford to be going walkabouts and celebrating. He needs to be working. You just never know which way the score's going to go.
And if we end up going to count back with tied scores, well, then the judges will express a preference as to who they perceive has been the better boxer. Via Farah Fori stealing a glance to his corner. What semaphore will he pick up in the form of instruction? He lets his hands go in rapid-fire fashion to the body. Kova reciprocates in that regard, but they've spent an awful lot of time in this type of posture. And again, perhaps the emotion of the neighbouring nation rivalry resulting in this untidy tango we've been seeing more often than not up in the ring. Good bolo left hand to the body from Via Farah Fori, looking for the same shot once again. Kova raising his arms contemptuously. There's a forearm smash in rabbit punch fashion from Via Farah Fori. Forearms going in, elbows following through. And the referee having his hands full remaining in charge of this one.
Oh,
it's another takedown.
Turn into wrestling.
So the styles not gelling in a particularly aesthetically pleasing fashion. Can't doubt the competitive spirit of either boxer. Is on the resumption, they both look to land at mid-range. Viafara Fori hasn't been able to make his attributes of longer range and reach tell. Cover has looked to maraud his way onto the inside. Each man has had, and there's another forearm smash after Viafara Fori. His momentum carried him forwards. What an untidy contest. Now, Viafara Fori thinks that he's done enough. So too does Cover. This is going to be really interesting on the scorecard. And again, point-scoring punches were at something of a premium, few and far between during the course of that contest. Cannot fault the competitive spirit or the desire of both of these men, who have each been crowned as continental champions of the Americas. That's from Canada in the north all the way down to Chile in the south. Here's the verdict. It could well be split. We may well be going to count back. Which way is this one going to go? I happen to think the man in blue has done enough, but what say the judges? Both boxers are confident. Again, when it takes so long to announce,
yeah,
going to take some working out by the judges. That will have to be handed over to the public address announcer. We could well find ourselves in the realm of count back here. Here's the verdict. And it's gone Cover's way. Jesus Cover, the reigning America's continental champion, prevailing on a 4-1 split over the man from Colombia. A really incident-filled, untidy encounter. But it is Jesus Cover who has eliminated the 2022 America's continental champion. And it's the reigning continental king of the Americas who progresses through to the quarterfinal stage, and he is now one win away from earning a precious Olympic quota. And again, the desire and determination of both of these boxers cannot be faulted, but celebrations abound in that red corner because their man got over the line on a 4-1 split decision after a really physical, incident-filled affair.
Yeah, it really, really was. Really messy fight. Very hard to score. I feel it could have gone either way after the points were deducted. But Cover did well to get through it. Here's the scores.
So, look at that. Three tied scores of 28 points apiece. And so those judges would have had to state their preference. And you see the second round is where the point deduction occurred, or the infringement occurred that resulted in a point deduction. And that is how a man from Venezuela has prevailed. Those three tied scores, all three of those who had it at 28-28, must have voted in favour of Cover, adding to the 29-27 tally that he took for judge number one. And that is how he prevailed on a 4-1 split. Incredibly close, the three 20-28, 28-28 scores, perhaps a fair reflection of what transpired. But when the three judges returned no verdict, they had to declare their preference, and they favoured Jesus Cover from Venezuela, and that is how he progresses through to the quarterfinal stage, where Adayev of Turkmenistan awaits. So we move up to the 92-kilogram division, and this a contest between boxers from Togo and Uzbekistan. There is Kevin Prudence, Fred Jovi from Togo, against the experienced figure of Laziz Mekmulajonov of Uzbekistan. The judges scoring this one hail from Azerbaijan, Korean Republic, Fiji, Algeria, and Sweden. Mr. Leonid Hanovic of Latvia is our third man in the ring. Laziz Mekmulajonov stopping Darius Vojnarovic of Lithuania in his first appearance. It was a victory over John Marvin of the Philippines on a 3-2 split for Kevin Kwadjovi of Togo. Four boxers make up the men's 92-kilogram bracket. I'm tempted to call it heavyweight, but as we've been explaining, nomenclature is there are no names assigned to the weight divisions in Olympic boxing following other Olympic weight-making sports. So it's 92-kilogram action forthcoming at the round of 16 stage. So we're underway then. It's a contest in the 92-kilogram division. It was previously known as heavyweight. Between boxers from Togo and Uzbekistan. The man wearing red, who is coming out aggressively, is Kevin Kwadjovi from Togo. He competed in the French National Championships, where he's been quarter-finalist in the couple of recent editions, but took the French national title in 2018 at 91 kilograms. His opponent, operating out of the southpaw stance, is one of the most experienced operators in the world, and that is Lazizbek Mullajonov, bronze medalist from the most recent World Championships. We commentated on Kevin Kwadjovi the other day, and he's a wonderful punch picker as he takes a hard southpaw left to the body, but look at where his hands are, and he seldom gets them back around his chin. And against an experienced operator like Mullajonov, well, that open chin could well present an inviting target. And he has a tendency to put his chin up in the air when he lets his shots go as well, Kwadjovi. Make no mistake, well, his shot's rendered inaccurate there, but invariably, straight shots are very accurate indeed. Relies on his reflexes, sees pulling his chin back as he's retreating. Mullajonov will be downloading all of that, so too will the Uzbek coaches. And he may well look to exploit the chin that is being presented as an inviting target. Halfway through the opening round, both boxers beyond range as they continue to feint. Each boxer looking for a backhand during that trade-off. But again, Kwadjovi really do fear for him, the manner in which he keeps his chin up in the air and his hands around his pecs. Hands down, chin up is often a bad combination in the sport of boxing. And in the 92-kilogram heavyweight division, well, need me to tell you that boxers of this proficiency are capable of ending a contest with a single shot.
Yeah, Mullajonov is doing really well here, I think, establishing the jab, just trying to pick his punches right. I feel he is waiting for Kajobi's chin to come up in the air so he can clock him.
And for a left hand to the body. Kwadjovi again, his hands in the on guard position around his pecs. And you can see he's not tucking that chin down into his chest. Mullajonov, again, he'll be just biding his time. He won't want to go head hunting. Just almost lure Kwadjovi into a sense of security and comfortability. There the hands are up of Kwadjovi. But again, as he reached for that counter right hand, his chin remaining up in the air like a weather vane.
I really like the way Mullajonov is always in distance, he's always in range. You can't see his feet at the moment, but they're very close together. He's just ready to attack.
So 3 minutes in the book. Watch your Uzbekistan coach go to work with that saturated towel in a bid to keep his man cool. Unsurprisingly, Lazizbek Mullajonov taking the first round unanimously, 10-9 for all five scoring judges. Stark contrast, Kwadjovi remaining on his feet in between rounds. Again, there is a significant gap in experience here. Although Kevin Kwadjovi used to compete in World Series boxing for the French team, faced off against Olympic medalists Clemente Russo and David Naika of New Zealand. So no stranger to the international scene. First saw him, Kwadjovi, at the Global Olympic Qualification event in Baku, where he lost against David Naika in the first preliminary round. In the blue corner. Into the second round then, Lazizbek Mullajonov, the reigning World Championship bronze medalist, here in his second attempt to qualify for the Olympic quota place, having been bested. Caused Kwadjovi to become disorganized and then scored with a left. But in Hangzhou, 2023 Asian Games, it was a quarterfinal finish against the marauding figure of Han Zhuzhen, Andrew Jen, inspired by a capacity crowd, summoned up energy from somewhere. A barrel of a heavyweight, short, thick set, and just kept on coming forwards, walking down Mullajonov and edged him out. At the quarterfinal stage on a 4-1 split, southpaw left not too far away. Well, I say not too far away, check the chin of Kouadjovi, and the referee diving in to issue an 8 count. Kouadjovi indicating to the referee that he's okay with a nod, and then gets his hands back to his on guard position, which is invariably around his chest. So he's backing straight up into the corner, and again Mullajonov now looking to bring that southpaw backhand into play. More than half of the round to negotiate for Kouadjovi, who's becoming just a little bit disorganized here now. And Mullajonov senses that. Look at him giving angles to Kouadjovi in a bid to set him up for that southpaw backhand that he went in search of once again. And he's just going from corner to corner here as a lead right hook. But then Kouadjovi firing back with a single of his own, and he's not protecting his chin, and these shots are clipping it consistently. A single standing count has already been issued.
Kouadjovi needs to be careful here. His chin's sky high in the air, and there's no defense whatsoever.
Mullajonov continuing to go in search of it with that southpaw backhand as Kouadjovi, when he gets himself out of the neutral corner, only to retreat towards another corner once again. This could be a long 50 seconds for Kouadjovi to negotiate to make it back to his corner to get some recovery and receive some instruction. Mouth open now, could well be feeling the pace, and his defense is absolutely nowhere. And again, the chin continuing to rise up as he lets his hands go. And this, we're almost waiting for the shot to land. There's an example of the quick-fisted accuracy of Kouadjovi, but he's paying no attention to the defensive side of the game. He tried to get his right glove up in position, but the shot was landed with sufficient force to twist his chin anyway. And Kouadjovi, well, he's got 15 seconds to negotiate to make it back to the corner. Southpaw right jab a la Larry Holmes, with it flicked out with the backhand. Mullajonov going to try to detonate a backhand before the bell. He doesn't do so. And Kouadjovi, well, he's made it through the second round, but it was a torrid round endured by the former French national champion. And you see, 10-8 across the board in round number two. Those are the scorecards returned, not just because of the 8 counts. They will have been significant factors in the 10-8 rounds being returned, because there's no doubt that Lazizbek Mullajonov was a clear winner of that second stanza.
Yeah, he really was. Just got behind the jab. Ooh, right hand to the body. And the chin's in the air, the head's in the air. Just, it's there for the taking.
But again, look at that. He disrupted the stance of Kouadjovi, that first southpaw left. And I'm not sure he ever recovered. There seemed to be quite a bemused look on his face for the remainder of the round. And even though his fighting desire will have remained intact, it just as though he looked as though he lost a little bit of control of his coordination. Has the 60-second interval been enough for his coordination to return to his full control? What sense will Lazizbek Mullajonov have up in the boxing ring? Kouadjovi coming out over the front foot to begin the final round. Left hand to the body is a scoring shot from Mullajonov. No limit to the number of 8 counts in men's Olympic style boxing. There's a limit of 4 on the women's side of the game. Mullajonov just checking his eyebrow to see whether that coming together resulted in a cut. The heads clashed. Mullajonov reaching for the southpaw left, but then got through with a jab. Now, I think that showboating has cost Mullajonov a standing count here. I think he was attempting to do what Billy Joe Saunders did against David Lemieux. Look over the top rope as if to say, that shot you sent in my direction is somewhere out there and I'm here. But the showboating, the referee not hip to it. And that's why Mullajonov has been issued with a standing count. There's a sharp southpaw left from Mullajonov. Southpaw left to the body scored by the World Championship bronze medalist. And Kouadjovi, well, he appears to have recovered, but again, the chin remaining high, and that's why it's clipped by a counter southpaw left. Here's a sharp right jab. And again, this is how Kwejovi goes about his work as he takes another pile driving southpaw left near the neutral corner. It's really unlikely that he would be able to change, box with his hands up in this Olympic qualifier. You see, he's gone from corner to corner, and way was no standing count. I think both boxers were expecting it.
Yeah.
That was a tremendous southpaw left that thoroughly checked the chin and punch resistance of Kevin Kwejovi, but no standing count forthcoming. And perhaps by pausing, Kwejovi has been allowed to recover, but he's gone straight from the neutral corner over to the red corner. And it's becoming something of a survival mission now for the former French national champion.
Well, I don't know, punch picking has been perfect. The footwork, the foot position, he's always got his lead leg on the outside of his opponent's foot, always keeping him in position.
So you see, Kwejovi went from the red corner to the neutral corner to the blue corner, and now he's back on the ropes on this red corner side of the ring. He's looking to use every space available in the canvas to remain away from Mullajonov. And even though there was no standing count forthcoming, I think he was hurt by that southpaw backhand that checked him on his jaw. Going to make it through to the final bell, but I think there'll be little doubt about the victory in this contest. Lazizbek Mullajonov will be going through to the quarterfinal stage in the men's 92-kilogram division. Again, in days of yore, this would have been referred to as the heavyweight division, but that no longer the case, as names have been removed from the numerical weight classes following the lead of other weight-making sports in the Olympic Games.
I really like the way Mullajonov controlled the bout there, using his footwork. Didn't really need to throw much. He was always in fighting distance, always on the razor's edge, making his opponent worry. Think about, oh, is he going to throw a shot? And then, just as his opponent switches off, Mullajonov go in there with a jab, a 1-2, catch his man off guard.
The winner by points, unanimous decision in the blue corner representing Uzbekistan.
So there is confirmation of a unanimous points decision victory for Lazizbek Mullajonov, prevailing over Kevin Kwejovi of Togo. He made it through to the final bell, and wonderful to see that respect and sportsmanship between the two boxers. Kwejovi, well, we said that he wasn't really paying much attention in terms of protecting his chin, and it was checked on a few occasions. A couple of standing counts in the second round. The shot that brought about the first standing count really did disrupt his balance. But he remained in there till the final bell, continued to compete. But the greater depth of experience under the belt of the reigning world championship bronze medalist, that is where Lazizbek Mullajonov thought he had brought about a standing count in the final round, but the referee didn't issue one. Comfortable victory for Lazizbek Mullajonov. Kevin Kwejovi, well, if he's selected by Togo, an opportunity to qualify for the Olympics remains at the final global qualifier in Thailand. But he's been bested here at the round of 16 stage today by the current World Championship bronze medalist. It was Lazizbek Mullajonov who goes through to the quarterfinal stage at 92 kilograms.
Beautiful boxing there by Mullajonov. As you can see, he's through to the quarterfinals. It'll be interesting to see who he's going to be up against next.
Next contest is between boxers from Georgia and Greece in the 92-kilogram division. There is the familiar figure, Georgi Kushitashvili, 28 years of age. He lives in the Georgian capital. His opponent is 24-year-old Vagkan Aznitazian from Greece. Five judges: USA, Canada, Puerto Rico, Netherlands, and Great Britain. Chia Chan Lin of Chinese Taipei is our referee. We take a look at the previous results for the man from Greece. Unanimous point decision victories over boxers from Australia and Croatia in the round of 64 and 32. Chualunga Shellstrata bested on a 3-0 split in the round of 32 by Georgi Kushitashvili. We are underway then. 92 kilogram action between boxers from Georgia and Greece. The figure wearing red is Georgi Kushitashvili, 28 years of age. His opponent wearing blue onto the front foot pretty quickly. Vagkan and it's Zanian. Both boxers want to let their hands go freely in the opening 30 seconds of this first round. Casually, very experienced figure. Into the ring as a reigning world championship bronze medalist, losing to the Olympic bronze medalist Lauren Berto Alfonso at the semi-final stage at the World Championships in Tashkent. I was ringside at the Humo Arena to commentate on that tournament last summer. It was a terrific run to the podium by Kushitashvili. As for Anit Zanian, he comes to the ring as the reigning European Cup bronze medalist. British national title last year as well.
Really like the way Kushitashvili is using his jab as a range finder and then going in and working the body, even though he's the taller man.
Her untidy tango will probably require the intervention of the referee, but she's content to try and let them work away. Neither boxer really able to do so. Well, it's Kushitashvili who's spoken about keeping his head up, with both men targeting the body on the resumption. Oh, it was Anik Zanian had him in a headlock, resulting in his head being around the belt line of his opponent. Kushitashvili on the front foot with a burst of clean work from long range, but now Kushitashvili applying the headlock. Well, he's unlucky there, because Nanit Zanian wasn't spoken to about the headlock he employed just a few moments before.
A really nice work there from the man in blue. Liked his body shots.
For the left hook to the body and looking to keep Nanit Zanian pinned in the corner is Kushitashvili. Physical contest this one. Lots of holding, lots of grappling. The referee having her hands full. Nice left hook on the inside twice from Kushitashvili before another tangle ensues. As though these two men are playing a game of twister. But this is anything but a party. The boxers competing for a quota place at the Olympic Games in Paris later this summer. But look at the amount of grappling and mauling that is punctuating the punches. Oh, there's a nice Scott shot to the body, followed by a clean right hand to the head. Moments of quality produced in the closing stages by the current World Championship bronze medalist, Georgi Kushitashvili of Georgia. And that is why he's taken the first round on a 4-1 split. Terrific burst of quality in the closing stages. Burst of punches downstairs, followed by a clean overhand right. Before the bell sounded.
I really like the way Kushitashvili was working there, going from head to body, the hooks to the body and then to the head. As you can see there, the straight right through the middle, just keeping his man off guard, forcing his man to just hold on. Man in Greece is going to really have to step up the work if he wants to try and pull some points back in this second round.
Referee calling time at the toll of the bell, just reminding the boxers that they are to keep their heads up. Straight back into the breach in another Maul Fest is Nanit Zanian. Again, forearms going in. That's a beautiful left hook twice in quick succession from Kushitashvili. And in between these this frenetic, frantic activity. It is Kushatajvili, who's just producing the more eye-catching quality for my money. 30 seconds have gone, and this one again, lots of pushing and pulling and tugging.
Nanet Setien has really come out firing in this round, which he needed to do. He's changed the tactics a little bit here.
Good work to the body from Kushatajvili beneath the elbows of Nanet Zanian. He's remaining in the pocket, but he's fashioning another clinch once again. And again, he hasn't really produced any quality to match that. That has come from the fists and feet of Kushatajvili. There he scores with a right hand to the body and left hook to the head of Kushatajvili. Kushatajvili back on the front foot and finding holes in the defences of Nanet Zanian once again. The final right hand in between the high-held gloves landed with a high elbow on a downward trajectory, and there he looks for the same shot once again as Nanet Zanian testing the tension of the ropes, leaning way back over the top, and you see the referee saying that you're not supposed to do that, even though that is a strategy that 1960 Olympic light heavyweight champion Muhammad Ali used to great effect in his contest against the 1968 heavyweight champion Big George Foreman in their epic rumble in the jungle in October 74.
I really love the jab of the man in red. It's just piercing through the guard.
And then, that is a beautiful right uppercut in between the high-held hands of Nanet Zanian as Kushatajvili looks to go through the gears here. The two men entwine limbs and torsos once again. But on the resumption, Kushatajvili again just looking to pierce and penetrate the defences of Nanet Zanian, who is bracketing his head with his hands, but Kushatajvili's accuracy is such that he's able to snake his gloves in between them. There a counter right hand to catch Nanet Zanian, wasn't too far away from Kushatajvili. And Kushatajvili, well, he's standing on the inside and letting leather fly, but I don't think the quality is comparable to that of the reigning world championship bronze medalist.
I think Nanet Zanian just hurt his man there in red. The shot just on the inside as they came together.
Again, the greater volume of quality punches for my money is coming from Kushatajvili. Shot landed on the bell was a left hook to the head after a right-hand body shot was fired in by Nanet Zanian. Certainly competitive, he really went for it emerging out of the blue corner, but I don't think he's won that round. Failing 20 points to 18 for four of the five judges. Because Kushatajvili was really able to find some consistent quality in the face of the flailing attacks he was facing from Nanet Zanian.
There was some really good work there by both fighters. Your man in blue came out firing on all cylinders, trying to score those points back. But he was just outboxed by the guy in blue, the guy in red. A beautiful uppercut there. Really picking his shots perfectly.
So into the third and final round then. Vagkan Nanet Zanian of Greece, reigning Greek national champion at 92 kilograms, really does need a massive final round here. Easiest way to secure passage through to the round of six, to the quarterfinal stage, is to get his man out of there inside the distance. Nothing wrong with the man's desire, because he's in there competing against the reigning world championship bronze medalist, the experienced figure of Georgi Kushatajvili. He returned to Georgia from Russia in the last month of 2019. You see Kushatajvili just engaging in bout management now, up on his toes and not going searching for offense at short and mid-range on the front foot as he did in the second round. His accurate punches consistently breach the defenses of Nanet Zanian.
Nanet Zanian really needs to put the work in here. He needs to stop falling over his feet when he's punching and ending up in a clinch. He needs to get his body centered so he can start throwing his combinations.
Approaching the halfway stage of this third and final round, there's a good two-shot salvo to the body of Nanit Zanyan, who continues to take shots downstairs. Good burst of accurate punching to the torso from Kushitajvili. He's now just edging backwards on the back foot, keeping the attack going. It was inaccurate from Kushitajvili. Nanit Zanyan continuing to press. Hasn't really found his range consistently during the course of this contest. Again, Kushitajvili doing a good job killing the clock here inside the final minute now. Got to remain concentrated. 92 kilogram international boxers know how to punch, and in the event that they get their weight behind a free shot, can have decisive consequences in terms of curtailing a bout. There's a beautiful right hand from Kushitajvili. Despite Nanit Zanyan again putting on the earmuffs, Kushitajvili was still able to find a gap in those defenses and a home for his right hand. Of course, neither boxer wants to be hit within a point deduction warning either. Nanit Zanyan over the front foot simply cannot work his way into his own punching range.
Yeah, he really can't. The distance is being controlled by the man in red, as he's just doing a bit of bout management here, time management, coasting round the ring, just trying to let the time tick away. And there we go.
So, nice respect shown between the two. It's Georgi Kushitajvili who will be going through to the quarterfinal stage. Remember, the winning quarterfinalist in 11 of the 13 weight classes, in every weight class with the exception of women's 57 and women's 60, will earn Olympic quota places that are up for grabs here. Let's get the official verdict, which should see Georgi Kushitajvili going through to the last eight. Confirmation of a unanimous points decision victory for the reigning world championship bronze medalist Georgi Kushitajvili of Georgia. Far too much knowledge and experience, and indeed ring craft, and compared to that of the 24-year-old Vagkant Nanit Zanyan. That is why he's receiving those congratulatory hugs from his corner team, because he remains in contention for an Olympic quota place. That's Georgi Kushitajvili.
Yeah, Nanit Zanyan just got outworked and outboxed in this one. He tried to get back into it, but his opponent was just a little bit too skillful for him.
And that is how he did it. Georgi Kushitajvili taking all three rounds for four of the five judges. Nanit Zanyan taking a share of the second round for judge number two. Or taking the second round for judge number two. A unanimous point decision verdict in favour of the reigning world championship third place finisher. Now one win away from earning an Olympic quota berth. There is confirmation of his progression through. Thought it would be, yes, it is confirmation, because he will face off against Lizbeth Mullajonov at the quarterfinal stage. So the bronze medalist from the most recent edition of the World Championships in Uzbekistan last summer will be facing off to earn an Olympic quota place that will take them through to Paris. The boxing tournament gets underway in 140 days' time. That contest in the quarterfinals scheduled for Monday. The afternoon session. Next up, we move to the heaviest weight class of all. It's a contest between boxers from Ireland and Bahrain. Martin McDonagh, just 21 years of age, stands 1.96 meters tall, comes to the ring as the reigning Irish national champion. His opponent, Denis Latipov, 33 years of age, and who was born in Russia, represents Bahrain. Tony Davis in the corner, issuing the instructions. He, the head coach of the Bahrain boxing program. So there, you see five scoring judges who come from Argentina, Slovakia, Algeria, Canada. Mr. Seru Whippy of Fiji is the referee. So this is action in the 92-kilogram plus division, previously known as super heavyweight, but names have been removed from the numerical weight classes in Olympic competition. Two big boxers going head-to-head. The towering figure wearing red is 6 foot 6 inch tall, 1.96 meter. Martin McDonagh, 21 years of age from Galway, comes to the ring as a reigning Irish national champion. Southpaw wearing blue, scoring with a good straight left cross to the body. Denis Latipov of Bahrain. He's in Hangzhou in China, commentating at the Asian Games when Latipov attempted to qualify through the continental route for Paris 2024. Lost to Kamshibek Kunkabayev at the quarter-final stage. So here he is in his second Olympic qualification event in his boxing road to Paris event. Good two-shot salvo from Latipov. Nice left hand on the end of that two-shot combination from McDonagh.
Yeah, McDonagh, I think he's looking to try and get his man out of here early today. But he needs to be careful. He's just getting clipped as he's coming in.
And between his own combination punching, Latipov just catching McDonagh on his bearded chin. And again, there's a right hand out of the southpaw stance that went over the left shoulder of McDonagh and caught him on the jaw. So just beyond the halfway stage of this opening round, Latipov looking to put his front foot outside of the lead left leg of McDonagh. Reddening around the right eye of McDonagh. There's a straight left he takes to the body from the southpaw wearing blue. And McDonagh, who came out aggressively on the front foot, now looking to utilize back foot boxing. And that's a cracking right hand that dips the knees of Latipov and disrupts his boxing stance. But he's recovered. And that reddening I referred to over the right eye of McDonagh has opened up as a cut. So let's keep an eye on the referee. But McDonagh had dipped the knees of his man. Latipov took the shot well and fired straight back. McDonagh looking to work the body and a furious fusillade of punches punctuated by that right hand downstairs causes Latipov to hold his feet, stand stock still, and he was worked over both to head and body during the course of that round, that moment of the round.
Latipov did really well there to stay on his feet after that barrage of punches.
Nice southpaw left picked by Latipov, but McDonagh knows now that he can hurt his man. But Latipov going in pursuit of him with his own southpaw left. Good combination punching through the defences of Latipov. But Latipov comes straight back. Terrific two-way action through this portion of the opening round. And again, the referee hasn't called for the intervention of the doctor, but the corner are after going to work immediately and assiduously on that damaged right optic of Martin McDonagh. What an opening round. And it is a 3-2 split in favour of Latipov. Perhaps a fair reflection of the two-way action we saw during the course of the opening three-minute frame.
Yeah, that is why you've got to keep on working right through to the very end of the bell. You can't afford to take your foot off the gas. McDonagh started off really, really strong, but he gave Latipov a chance to come back into the fight, went on his back foot.
Then McDonagh came back, and this was his best portion of the round. Success to both head and body, and look at the extent to which that final body blow doubled over Latipov, but he came back strong again. High five from Tony Davis in that blue corner. Zahar Antia, the Irish head coach, on the perimeter of the ring with some final words of encouragement and instruction. We're only one in 1,000 adrenaline solution applied, or permitted to be applied to that eye injury. Non-petroleum jelly as well in Olympic style boxing. As we move into the second round, and the 92 kilogram plus formerly super heavyweight division.
Really good defense there by Latipov. He's trying to work his way into the inside of the guard of McDonough.
And McDonough looking for that lead left hand. And again, not seeing the feet at the moment, but Latipov looking to keep his foot outside the lead left leg of McDonough. McDonough has done a good job closing the cut and preventing it from leaking.
Oh.
Beautiful right jab from Latipov. My goodness, that was rapid. But look at the response it brings as McDonough gets on the front foot. Latipov leaning way back over the ropes. And the referee, Mr. Seru Whippy from Fiji, telling Latipov that he's not to do that. A good shot to the body on the resumption from Latipov. There's a southpaw left straight down the pipe, jolting the head back of McDonough. McDonough operating behind a low-held guard now, reciprocating that being proffered by Latipov.
Really good work there from Latipov. He's really settled into the second round, picking his punches beautifully, making his man miss, and then making him pay.
Latipov just electing to go on the back foot. Nice cuffing right hand. Not sure whether it was landed with sufficient force, but that double jab certainly was from Latipov. Then a roundhouse left, good portion of the round, but then McDonough responds with good shot to the body, and the left hand to Latipov's body may well have hurt the Bahrain boxer, but he comes back with a southpaw left cross of his own. Good portion of the round for McDonough, but now Latipov looking to re-establish what he feels is the natural order of things as he goes to work with his own straight punches once again. Oh, that's a cracking reverse 1-2 right left from McDonough. Up on his toes, but then back comes Latipov with a two-shot salvo out of that southpaw stance. And again, with the boxers electing to operate behind low-held guards, the chins are remaining open. And at this juncture, neither boxer utilizing enough head movement to make their opponent miss when those headshots are being fired in.
I think McDonough may have gassed himself out in the first round, throwing all those combination punches. He seems to be starting to wilt a little bit in this second round.
Closing 20 seconds of this second stanza. Intervening with a command of head up. Donna off the mark, slapped by a right hand from the southpaw wearing blue, then a counter left hand. And again, Latipov reducing the power in the closing stages of round number two, but increasing the volume as he continued to touch up Martin McDonough with cuffing punches in the closing stages of the round. So look at that. We have four scorecards at a dead level at 19 points apiece. Latipov taking both of the completed rounds for the judge from Argentina, judge number one. Remember, Latipov edged the first round on a 3-2 split, but the distribution of scores in the second round mean that we are dead level for judges 2 through 5 with 3 minutes of boxing remaining. This one in the balance.
Yeah, it really is. Latipov did really well in that round, I think, managing the onslaught that was coming towards him. But it's all on this round now. McDonough's done really well to keep himself in this fight. And if he pulls out some punches here, could see this bout overturned.
So both boxers sent to opposing neutral corners after the referee is reminding the boxers of their responsibility to keep their heads up. We're into the third and final round of this 92 kilogram plus encounter, the biggest boxers in Olympic competition. And it is all square after 6 minutes of boxing for four of the five scoring judges. That southpaw left not too far away. That right jab was right on the money from Latipov, snapping the head back of McDonough, as does that southpaw left. So again, Latipov increasing his activity, busy with his lead hand in particular. McDonough gets in a left hook to the body, but Latipov just able to dip beneath the following shot. Right hand straight down the pipe was a flicking shot scored by McDonough, but he was countered by a looping left and then a good burst of successful, accurate punches from Latipov at mid-range.
to be some really good. Oh!
Hard right hand to the body causes Latipov to buckle back into the ropes once again. And McDonough has had particular success when he has dropped downstairs. That was a low blow, and you saw Latipov grimace immediately. But he's retained his boxing stance, continuing to bob and weave. Pops out a single shot, which scores straight down the middle. McDonough scores with a right hand against the southpaw, but Latipov responds immediately. Terrific burst of punches, knocking the head back of McDonough, followed by a left cross, right jab, and another left-right combination. Good portion of the round for Latipov. Both men feeling the pace. McDonough willing himself forwards. Latipov trying to keep him at bay. And now with Latipov pinned against the ropes, McDonough was looking to go to work, but he didn't enjoy the success that he had previously with Latipov against the ropes. But he did there with two short shots to check the chin of Latipov. Beyond the halfway stage, both men feeling the pace and the efforts of their exertions. Good reverse 1-2, and then another backhand success from the southpaw, followed by a left uppercut during that successful cluster of punches from Latipov. That was a sustained moment of quality. McDonough comes back with right-hand success to the body of his own.
Yeah, McDonough's done really, really well trying to push the pace of this fight, getting his combos off, trying to pin his man on the ropes. He has some success. Oh,
beautiful lead left hand out of the southpaw stance from Latipov. And in addition to the injury over the right eye, there's a nick beneath the right eye of McDonough as well. Trying to pin Latipov to the ropes once more. Barrels in a bolo shot to the body. Beautiful crisp left uppercut from Latipov despite being pinned against the ropes. Closing 20 seconds of what has been an utterly absorbing contest, and third and final round in particular, as McDonough wills his way forwards once again, takes a half hook, half uppercut from the southpaw in blue. He scores with a shot to the body, but he's countered by a furious fusillade of punches from Latipov, who's working effectively off the ropes once again. What an absolutely pulsating affair in the 92 kilogram plus super heavyweight division. Martin McDonough willed his way forwards, fighting his way through the fatigue, but he ran into some accurate combinations fired out by the southpaw from Bahrain, Denis Latipov. The marks of battle evident on the face of Martin McDonough in his pursuit of an Olympic quota place. Cut above the right eye in round number 2, cut beneath the right eye in round number 3. Wonderful sportsmanship shown between the boxers and the boxers and opposing coaches as well. For what it's worth, I happen to think that Latipov did enough in the third and final round. Remember, we had 4 scorecards of 19 points apiece going into the third and final round. Here's the official verdict. If we hear unanimous, it's immediately Latipov. It could well be split.
Split decision in the group.
And there is confirmation of a split decision verdict for Bahrain's Denis Latipov at the end of an absolutely riveting 92 kilogram plus super heavyweight bout. He edges it on a 3-2 split to get over the line against the reigning Irish national champion Martin McDonough, who played his part in what was a terrific contest filled with two-way action, with the momentum swung back and forth. But in a final round where the scorecards were tied at 19 points apiece for 4 of the 5 judges, it was Latipov who was just able to produce more quality on a sustained basis to edge ahead and indeed over the line ahead of McDonough. But what a terrific super heavyweight bout we've just witnessed.
Yeah, this was everything. It had the excitement in there, the work rate. Latipov would just box beautifully. Just catching his man through his guard, round the sides of his guard and through the middle of his guard with some accurate straight shots along with some body shots. Here's the scores.
So look at that. Martin McDonough actually taking the final round, but the distribution of the scores were such that Latipov taking it 29-28, 3-2. Judges 3 and 5 preferring the work of Martin McDonough overall. And you can see how those scores have been distributed. That a fair reflection as to just how competitive that contest was. Absolutely riveting from opening bell to last. Both boxers deserve immense credit. But it is Denis Latipov who remains in contention for an Olympic quota place here in Northern Italy. Martin McDonagh will surely hope, after the manner in which he's acquitted himself, that he will be selected by the Irish Federation for the final Olympic qualifier in Thailand at the end of May into the start of June. Because it wasn't for a lack of effort that he was bested here, and he was bested by a razor-thin margin. So the final bout of this 17th session of boxing, 18th session of boxing, excuse me, is between Italy's 22-year-old Diego Lenzi and his 25-year-old opponent from Spain, Gadfa Drissel Al-Isui. Five scoring judges come from Tajikistan, Netherlands, Sweden, Kazakhstan, and Chinese Taipei. Manuel Ferreira Valentin of Puerto Rico is the referee. He brings boxers to center ring for the final instructions. Underway then, final contest of this 18th session of boxing on day 7 of the Boxing Road to Paris events here in northern Italy. This one between boxers from the host nation, Italy, and Spain. The tattooed figure wearing red is Diego Lorenzi, 22 years of age, quarter finalist in the under 22 European Championships held last summer in Budva in Montenegro. Second Olympic qualification event for him. He competed in the multi-sport extravaganza that are the European Games in Krakow. Lost in the second preliminary round of that first attempt to qualify. The man who just landed a good right hook to the body, Ayub Gadfa Drissi El Aisawi of Spain. Minute gone in this opening round. El Aisawi of Spain comes to the ring as the reigning world championship bronze medalist. Didn't appear in his semi-final, so thereby losing on walkover against a man who would go on to claim his second world championship gold, and that is the imperious Olympic champion Bakadir Jalolov of Uzbekistan.
Lenzi's just struggling to find his range here, being the shorter fighter coming forward, but he's just tending to smother his work a little bit. Swinging with a wide hook there, man in red,
El Aisawi, just catching his opponent in the crook of his elbow. You see Lenzi, just 1.85 meters tall, so in many respects a sawn-off super heavyweight. He's often competing against a lack of inches, thick-set, muscular figure, tremendous lower body development. And that means he has invariably got to bob and weave his way inside and look to launch bent-arm attacks, particularly to the body, because he's often the shorter opponent up at 92 kilograms plus. And see from the development on the man's legs, I don't think he's going to make 92 anytime soon. Because that looks those rock solid developments of quads and hamstrings and glutes and calves. El Aisawi searching for straight shots, but tucking up effectively is Lenzi. There you see the role of Lenzi trying to get inside, but then he found El Aisawi leaning down on him.
Right hand there from Lenzi.
So the first round in the book. Lots of clinching in these boxers of contrasting statures. 4-1 split in favour of the reigning world championship bronze medalist Ayub El Aisawi from Spain.
And you can just see there, El Aisawi just covering up, trying to weather the storm from his opponent in red, and just trying to come back with and find the range for the for his counter punches. Lindsay's going to have to step it up in this round, try to get inside of his opponent's reach so he'll be able to get his shots off. Here we go, round two.
So the second round underway. Alaoussi took the first round on a 4-1 split. Lindsay coming out. More urgency, the heads coming together again as another clinch ensues. Rather untidy, this one. And again, Lindsay so committed to trying to get inside. But in the event that he misses, he often finds himself chest to chest. Counter left hook landed after the command of stop. Because the referee from Puerto Rico is reminding Lindsay that he is to keep his head up. Here he lands a good left jab to the body after he stepped into range on quick feet on that explosive forward movement, and again looking for hooks, and the final right hook did get through, just knocking Alaoussi off balance.
And Lindsay's doing well here to just weather the storm of that. Oh, good shot there by the man in blue.
So a good burst of straight punches to the body from Lindsay. Alaoussi. Again, he seems to be the boxer initiating most of the clinches. Right uppercut, left hook, not too far away from Alaoussi. You can understand why he's initiating clinches, because in the event that Lindsay gets inside his greater reach, well, he wants to tie him up and prevent him from working away. Covered up effectively there behind his gloves and forearm did Alaoussi. But then you see he wraps up his man once again. Left jab to the body on the resumption. Cuffing shot landed on the inside by Lindsay, but that second left hook was altogether more correct. Landed solidly before a forearm smash caused Alaoussi to touch down. Spoken to about the illegal move of rabbit punching. So Lindsay demonstrating the explosivity he possesses when he gets those hooks off at short range. But that is where he has got to be for the entirety of the 3 minutes. There he lands a long-range roundhouse right for him and then targets the body again. His left hook is so heavy that wherever it lands, it seems to knock the man off balance, but he's going to be docked a point here for not keeping his head up. The referee has spoken to him about that infringement on several occasions. In this instance, he has elected to take a point. Lindsay perhaps a little bit harshly done by, lands a right cross on a resumption, followed by another slapping left hand, followed by some nice head movement.
Lindsay's doing really well here, trying to draw his man into a fight. Someone where Lindsay feels really a lot more comfortable. Oh, good shot there.
And again, the weight of his punch is evident from our commentary position. Oh, that's a solid right hand driven straight down the middle. And it caused Alaoussi to bend backwards like a limbo dancer. Terrific force on that final right cross. But he retained his boxing stance, remained on his feet. And Diego Lindsay, remember, he's been docked a point for excessive or for dipping his head low. But Alaoussi leading for four of the five judges. But Lindsay has demonstrated that he seems to possess the fight-ending power. Well, I mean, Alaoussi has got to remain switched on and locked in for the entirety of the final 3 minutes.
Yeah, Lindsay really needs to pick up the pace here if he wants to try and pull this back. But the man in blue is doing really well here to just keep scoring the points and trying to keep his man at bay, because the guy in red is going to come for him now.
So Diego Lindsay, having been hit with a point deduction in that second round, comes forward on another explosive forward foray with it behind a treble jab. Alaoussi trying to establish his jab, and then behind it came a left-right combination. And I'm rather surprised as Lindsay lands another pile-driving right cross. Good defense with a right glove from Alaoussi. But I'm rather surprised that Alaoussi didn't elect to box at this type of distance in the first two rounds, because he found himself here an awful lot. And again, it's physical, it's grappling on the inside, but at that distance, it brings Lenzi right into the proceedings. So El Aissaoui trying to establish that long-range jab from distance rather than looking for power punches at short and mid-range. And there he landed a left jab, right cross. Had to reach for it a little bit. Didn't take his feet with him. But look at the distance that Lenzi has got to try and make close in a bid to get his own heavy artillery away.
Yeah, El Aissaoui's got the right idea here. He needs to keep his man at bay, stay as far away from him as possible, and just time manage this fight. Don't get caught with anything silly.
And again, at distance, he's working his jab effectively. Lenzi, oh, he looking a little bit frustrated in there now. And on the resumption, good left-right combination, but it was landed with bent arms. And that is why Lenzi was able to score to the body. El Aissaoui looking to increase the gap once again. I should also point out that El Aissaoui has been spoken to on a number of occasions after Lenzi spoken to again about employing headlocks. So El Aissaoui won't want to pick up a point deduction. Nice right uppercut on the inside from Lenzi. And now El Aissaoui finds himself in Lenzi's wheelhouse once again, toe-to-toe at short range. And again, Lenzi walks back in the front door and helps himself to a three-shot combination, ending with that left hook to the body and another clumping right hand. When he's able to get his legs beneath his punches, Lenzi really does get plenty of leverage on them. And the shots are so heavy that invariably they disrupt the boxing stance of El Aissaoui.
Yeah, Lenzi's done really well here. He hasn't given up in any of the rounds. Trying to walk his man down, trying to land his shots, ducking and weaving.
El Aissaoui cutting a bit of a fatigued figure here now, and perhaps it's that reason as he takes a right uppercut on the inside, then a burst of punches to the body, followed by a rather crude-looking right hook upstairs. And I think that is the sole reason why El Aissaoui is having difficulty maintaining the gap. Lenzi still in search of the knockout finish that he's in pursuit of, letting hooks go on the inside. El Aissaoui clinging on desperately, boxing stance betraying him, and despite the fatigue enveloping him almost entirely in the closing stages of the contest, I believe that Ayoub El Aissaoui of Spain has done enough. So too do his corner. It was a spirited effort from Diego Lenzi. Never stopped competing. Dr. Point, perhaps a little quickly in the course of the second round for failing to keep his head up, but that it was after being spoken to on several occasions. I think the man in blue has done enough to be declared as the victor here. But what say the five scoring judges? Lenzi feels that he has done enough to progress through to the quarterfinals.
Here come the scores. This may be a split.
Ring A, the winner by points, split decision in the red
corner. Oh, and it's the red corner. Diego Lenzi declared a split decision victor, and just look at what it means to him. Prevailing on a 3-2 split decision verdict, and he exploded into exuberant celebrations, because his quest for an Olympic quota place remains alive here in his home nation of Italy. As for Ayoub El Aissaoui, he is crestfallen. But good to see that respect between the two. Just a moment of silent introspection for Ayoub El Aissaoui after that verdict was announced, a verdict that has gone against him. But Lenzi sportingly holding open the ropes at the conclusion of what was a really close affair. He absolutely delighted, and in stark contrast, El Aissaoui bitterly disappointed. I'd be interested to see the scores here, because I'm not quite sure how Diego Lenzi could have turned that one around. If he managed to get it to count back, then maybe his front foot pressure was rewarded or preferred by the judges. But I think Ayoub El Aissaoui desperately unlucky when you consider the context of the contest going into the third and final round. That point deduction may have been harsh against Diego Lenzi in the second round. So take that out of the mix, which you can't really. But if you do, then it was a close physical affair. But given the state of the scorecards going into round three, well, let's take a look at how he's done it. And there you've got it, see. 29-27 for Eli Sawi. And then scorecards of 28-28 for judges 4 and 5. Diego Lenzi taking it 29-27 for judge number 3. So the two judges who had it deadlocked at 28 points apiece have preferred the work of Diego Lenzi. And that is how he has edged it on a 3-2 split. Again, I feel that Eli Sawi is desperately unlucky. Credit to Diego Lenzi for digging deep and tying it up on the scorecards of judges 4 and 5, because those two tied scores combined with the one that he was judged to have taken empirically for judge number 3, their preference, the preference of judges 4 and 5 on countback, have seen him prevail and progress through to the quarterfinal stage by the narrowest of margins. Bitter disappointment for Ayoub Eli Sawi. It's Diego Lenzi, the Italian boxer, who remains in contention for an Olympic quota place.
I think Lenzi did well there in the last round. He stuck to his guns. He never stopped coming forwards, kept on throwing punches. And his man in blue started to look a bit sloppy. And maybe that's what changed the judges' minds, you know. The more eye-catching shots. And he looked like, the man in blue looked like he was flailing around a little bit. And things like that can change their minds.
Most certainly. He appeared to be fighting on fumes in the closing stages of the third and final round, Eli Sawi. He and his corner were convinced that they had done enough, but as Nicola Adams, the double Olympic champion, has pointed out, Diego Lenzi never stopped competing, as we take a look at some of the images that unfolded during the course of this 18th session of boxing. Our first Olympian was declared, and that is in the women's 60-kilogram division with Chelsea Heijnen of the Netherlands. The World Championship bronze medalist outpointed Miroslava Jedinakova of Slovakia. By winning her semi-final, she is the first person to punch her ticket through to Paris 2024. But some terrifically competitive action all the way through the card.
Yeah, there really was. I really liked Sokovic and Hernandez as well. The punch power, the accuracy, the speed, and Ngamba really, really impressed me in this session today. There was some great boxing, some good stuff from the heavy men as well.
And that was the moment of confirmation that kept Diego Lenzi in contention for an Olympic quota place. And just look at the contrast in emotions, head in the hands moment for Eli Sawi. And that concludes the 18th session of boxing. Make sure you check local listings. We'll be back on air in under 2 hours' time, or just over 2 hours' time, for session number 19 as we continue to edge closer to those Paris qualification berths. For Nicola Adams and the rest of the team here in Northern Italy, I'm Ronald McIntosh saying thank you for staying with us, and join us again for session number 19 in Ring A. We'll see you very soon. Bye for now.